part of Tokyo Beat. We had some guys show up. Some guys were coming.
Okay.
To our new place. But it was like four or five middle-aged guys from the building.
Okay. And they weren't wearing track suits or just fancy suits in general?
No. These were regular guys.
And they didn't have like those lawyer badges?
No.
Okay.
We saw there was a thing posted in the lobby for about a month that was like, hey, we're cleaning the pipes in the building.
I see.
On this, we're going around to all the apartments on these days, and we're like, okay, cool.
Uh-huh.
And I guess
two burly plumbers.
It was four, and they weren't terribly burly.
Okay.
We didn't know that meant they would be coming inside and like literally cleaning our drains and pipes.
Well, where else are the pipes going to be, Alex?
I don't know.
They don't
I
hang
thought
off
maybe
the side of the building like Blade Runner.
No, they don't. They don't. 224. They I don't know what we expected.
With noodles.
I trust that my wife knows what she's talking about when I ask her about these things because she is Japanese and I am not.
Okay.
But the fact of the matter is it doesn't matter what universe you're from. That's got to hurt. It doesn't matter where you are from. There are just certain processes that we are both unfamiliar with.
Okay.
And so, yeah, these guys it's 8 a.m. I am asleep. My wife's getting ready for work.
Well, timely.
Yeah.
Better than waiting all day.
And like, I wake up to the sound of, I just hear a lot of voices in the entryway. I just hear my wife talking to a bunch of middle-aged guys. And I get up and I stumble to the entryway in my pajamas. And
I'm Alex.
They all kind of laugh like, oh, how good I'm awesome. I'm like,
he's not one of us.
One of them pointed at me and said, un forastero. It's real awkward. Yeah. Right. So we let him inside and they did their cleaning, and I was so frantic, I was like panicking that I bumped into our living room coffee table, and I knocked a persimmon onto the rug that because my mom sent us a fruit basket for our anniversary, and I guess it was we hadn't eaten all the fruit, and there was a persimmon that I bumped that apparently was a little overripe, and it hit our new rug and just exploded.
Oh, Jesus.
And so I'm like trapped in this hell cycle, in this combination of dealing with strangers in our house while trying to clean up what will be a permanent stain on our new rug. And I'm just a severe panic state.
I've had moments like that.
It's the worst. It sucks. On the upside, drains look immaculate.
Okay. Did they show you?
Yes. Yeah. There's very. I mean, we've only been here since.
The camera down there. No, it's a thing though.
Yeah. 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 They lubed up the camera. They put it up my butt.
No, not you.
Oh.
Wait. Whose pipes are we talking about?
No. They. I mean, we've only been here since October, so the pipes haven't really had that much time to get dirty. But I guess it's a kind of buildup that happens slowly, so you don't notice when it happens.
Did they clean them before you moved in?
The entire place was brand new when we moved in.
Oh.
Which is, on the one hand, exciting, but on the other hand, it means, well, this place got nowhere to go but down.
Right, but it wasn't new construction.
Not the building.
I mean, yes, it was renovated.
Yes.
But, yeah, okay.
But it was, like, completely renovated, as in new sink, new everything, new fixtures.
New pipes.
New pipes!
Amazing.
Yeah.
I guess, that did happen to our house, too.
Yeah.
Last year, they basically replaced all of the pipes.
Oh, wow.
And most of the electrical wiring.
Cool.
Yeah.
Should we have saved this for our bonus show, Pipe Dreams?
No, I think we can let him in on this one for free.
All right. Here's a little freebie.
Yeah. Keep him wanting more, right?
Yeah.
Well, that's exciting. I assume you, in celebration, spent all day on the toilet.
Yeah.
Because you enjoy your coffee as well.
And that's true.
Your snacks.
I do.
What are you eating lately? What are you pooping lately?
It's gross. I'm eating these, it's like these toasted beans from the supermarket that are gross. Super good. No, they're great. I don't know. I don't even know what they're called. They're big. They're like...
garbanzo?
No, I don't know. How big is a garbanzo?
I don't know. It sounds big, right? That's a big sounding word.
It also sounds like garbage.
You know, different strokes.
Sounds like a portmanteau of garbage and gonzo. Uh-huh. The Muppet. Popular Muppet, Gonzo.
Right.
Originator of gonzo journalism, I believe.
Yes. Not the other gonzo.
No.
Not the other kind of gonzo media that you would say gross to.
Is gonzo... I bet gonzo is a Japanese word. Hang on, I'll look that up. Or at the very least, a Japanese name. Hang on, it could mean cancer elephant. I need to look this up.
No, because it has an O in it. It'd be gonzo.
Oh my God! Gonzo. Gonzo is counterfeit, forgery, or fabrication.
Cool.
Yeah, so you want to come over and watch Muppets?
That describes the fake news journalism machine in this country, that's for sure.
Did I ever tell you about my fan theory about Muppet Baby's nanny and Inspector Gadget's Dr. Claw?
What is the theory, Alex? That they're the same person or related or just husband and wife or something?
Husband and wife, yes.
Okay, there we go.
Because they have the same air of mystery where you never see their face.
Yeah.
And they both take care of Muppets.
And they're both evil.
No, Nanny's fine.
If you say so.
I do say so.
She's an oppressor. No, that didn't hit? Okay.
Remember that episode where they play with Nintendo?
Yes.
But they called it Pretendo?
Yes, they did.
Right?
They did.
Remember that episode where Keith Hernandez spit on Miss Piggy?
Not particularly. It's No More Whoppers. Welcome to the show, everybody. My name is Ray Barnhold, independently dependent, and with me as always, tile grout installer to the stars, Alex Fraioli.
It doesn't install itself, and I will do it for a nominal fee.
Yeah. Nominal means that's small, right?
Yeah, sorry. Let me take that again. I will do it for a substantial fee.
Okay, yeah, because you're doing it for the stars.
That's right.
Jennifer Aniston can afford it.
Yes!
Yeah.
They got money to burn!
Cool. It's another episode we're doing. How about it?
It is. I was up early because I was so excited to do this episode.
I see. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. You've been really improving your life lately.
I have. No, I was actually up early because my wife forgot her wallet.
Okay.
Usually what happens is I usually sleep in till like 10 or 11 or 12, depending, because I have the freedom to do that because my job is in the evening. But I will spring awake like one of Pavlov's dogs when I hear the jingle of my wife's keys as she is about to leave for work, which is, you know, depending on her shift, could be 9 or 9:30 or 10.
Sure.
And as soon as I hear the jingle of the keys, I spring out of bed because I want to see her off to work. And I give her a hug and a kiss and I see her out the door and then I go back to bed.
And fantastic.
I did that this morning.
Yeah.
And then as I'm drifting off to sleep again, my phone starts blowing up.
Uh-huh.
And I answer the phone. And it's very weird. My policy on telephone calls, and that is...
Don't do them?
Don't do them.
Yeah.
Specifically...
I'm with you.
The only reason anyone should call me on the telephone is if you are dying and I am the only person in the world who can save you.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Or if you're my wife. And it was the latter. So I answer the phone and I was like, hello. And she's like, check my desk. Where's my wallet? She doesn't sound like that.
No, I hope not.
Oh, Homer. So yeah, I just found her
Alex
wallet.
Alex is white, everybody.
Found her wallet, brought it to her at work. And by the time I got home, it was like, well, if I go back to bed now, I could get like maybe 15 minutes of sleep before the show. So I'm just going to stay up and make some coffee. And I did.
I see. You just got coffee? You didn't also like go get a donut or something?
Oh, I made oatmeal. Don't worry. I was going to stop on the way home, there's a place called Bucho Coffee in our neighborhood that is actually pretty famous.
Wasn't that the name of the goose that died?
Yes, we named it Bucho as a little joke. This is the same Bucho. There's a Japanese drama series about a salaryman who just goes around Japan eating everything.
Whoa. Back up.
It's a food show that my wife enjoys. I forget what it's called. It started out as a manga.
Right, yeah.
It's a food manga. But one of the episodes was filmed at Bucho Coffee, right in our neighborhood. Yeah. And I like it a lot. I like that place. My wife does not like it as much. I like the atmosphere. It's a real homey kind of Japanese. Like, cafe culture is pretty big in Japan, and it's especially big here in Nagoya. I don't know why, but we're wild about cafes. This one's good. It's got
cafe
good
capital
coffee.
Of the world.
It's got good food. It is.
Yeah.
We invented coffee.
Yes, of course.
Someone might tell you it was invented in the Middle East. They would be wrong.
Yeah, whatever.
Yeah.
Solitary Gourmet, I believe, was the show you're probably thinking of.
That's the one, yes. But Bucho Coffee is great. But because it's great, it's always crowded. So I didn't want to wait 30 minutes for a cup of coffee. So I just went home and brewed my own.
All right.
How you like that?
I don't like it because I said donut.
Oh.
You could have got a special snack to celebrate you getting up early.
I did pass a Mr. Donut. Well, that's the downside of living in the city where, once again, you know you got to survive.
Yep.
You have to keep that dream alive.
Mm-hmm.
Is that if you try to go to any place that has food in the morning, the afternoon, or the evening, they're always crowded. So I have sort of conditioned myself to just not eat out ever unless it's a weird hour. Like, it's 10:50.
All right, cool.
Or 3:07. Yeah, yeah, I can get a sandwich now.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah, living in the city is great, but sometimes it sucks.
Yeah, true.
How was your morning?
My morning was fine. I could tell you about the past month as well.
Do it. Wait, hey, do you have any, what?
What? Do I have any what?
Do you have any baby news?
We'll get into it.
All right. Okay.
Let me start by saying first, hey, life achievement unlocked.
Ooh.
Called 911 for the first time.
Uh-oh.
Recently.
Oh, no. Is everything okay?
Everything's fine.
Okay,
by now.
Oh.
My mother basically threw her back out. She got a slip disc.
Oh, no.
And was spending a couple days in immense pain and finally just couldn't stand it and asked me to get an ambulance for her one morning. And so I just did that. Of course, called 911.
Okay.
And calmly explained the situation and everything.
Okay. I thought 911 was for emergencies, though. Can you just do a casual 911 call?
I don't think there's a way to do a casual ambulance request.
Really? There must be.
There is a independent police line.
Okay.
You can call the police without having to call 911. Also, wow. I don't really know, Alex. I just called 911 because that is the thing we've all been taught in our lives to do. So,
yeah, in emergencies, though, right? I mean,
it's kind of an emergency if my mother cannot exactly stand up for much longer than seconds at a time and is really groaning and in fact is just, you know, getting sick from it. So, yeah.
All right. Okay. Sure.
Are you really debating this with me? I'm telling a story here.
Surely there's some kind of like Uber, but they'll take you to the hospital. Like, oucher, let's call it.
What is going on?
No, I'm not debating that your mom was in pain and needed to go to the hospital. I'm questioning, is 911 the only option that Americans have for an ambulance? Why isn't there also a casual ambulance?
I'll bring it up at the city council meeting next time. Okay?
Thank you.
All right, great. Anyway, yeah, she basically caused this by lifting a very heavy garbage bag.
Oh, no.
And then woke up the next day in a lot of pain. Then had one too many aspirin and got nauseous off of that.
Oh, boy. Oh.
For an extended period of time. Not unlike when I overdosed on aspirin on the Shinkansen and had to vomit.
No.
And then, you know, another day of dealing with that. And then she eventually, not unlike your wife, calls me in the early morning from her room to my room and says,
okay,
please just call 911.
Oh boy.
And we did that.
Wait.
So yeah. Oh. What now?
No, like what, she called you as in with her voice or on a phone?
On the phone.
Why didn't she call 911?
I'm going to reiterate that she was in immense pain.
Okay.
And didn't really want to deal with it. Also is 80 years old.
Okay. All right. Well, there
just
you go.
Just doesn't want to have to stutter her way through that kind of conversation.
All right.
I think you can understand that.
I can.
Anyway.
All right. Well, I'm glad
that
she's
all happened.
First,
the fire
better.
Truck came, but it was very quick. The fire truck came. So not even an ambulance at first.
Wait, what?
The whole fire truck came, and then the firefighters came up to basically assess the situation and wait for the actual ambulance. I don't understand that either. I know you have questions already. I'll bring that up at the city council meeting as well, okay?
I'm slowly lowering my hand. Okay.
Nevertheless, they came very quickly, and they, I believe, got mom started on some morphine.
Okay.
While cool. waiting for the ambulance, and that was just another few more minutes. And so the ambulance, they had their special rig to cart mom down the stairs. You know, they got the special thing that just sort of has rubber, you know, ski type feet on it, sledding type rubber things that you just, you know, take it down the stairs. So the person doesn't have to be, you know, carted on an actual bed horizontally. And then gets put on the bed and then taken to the emergency room. I knew she would be okay there, so we just let her get checked in there at the nearby hospital. Same hospital we had the baby, of course.
Oh, fun.
So I was somewhat familiar with the emergency room. And then I followed a couple hours later and checked her out, got her checked out of the hospital. Because she was already properly drugged up and had a prescription and all that, and took her home. And then, her prescription was for oxycodone.
Cool.
Which, of course, is an opioid.
Sure.
And they won't give you more than one prescription, or refill, rather. Because it is what they call a controlled prescription. So mom just had to essentially survive on a rapidly dwindling amount of oxycodone before her follow-up appointment at some random doctor's office. But we did get that done. She did survive through that. And basically was just told to just take a bunch of ibuprofen. Not a bunch, but ibuprofen is basically the main thing that they're going to give you for a certain amount of pain, right?
Yes. I took two this morning. Yeah. Feel fantastic.
Of how many milligrams?
I don't know. They're the orange ones I got from Costco.
Okay.
And actually, I think they've been probably expired for like 4 years. So I just hope they still work.
Fantastic.
Maybe less.
Still
maybe
work.
Less well.
It's not a fucking, it's not a Nintendo.
I blow on them. Am I supposed to blow on them?
RGB mod these pills.
But they do expire after which point I think their effectiveness is lessened.
Mm-hmm. That's how it
but
works.
When I say they still work, what I mean is I had a headache when I took them. Yeah. I no longer have a headache.
Okay.
And I'm playing Rygar.
I was going to add, that's what they gave me when I had that kidney stone.
Rygar?
They sent me home with a bunch of ibuprofen.
Okay.
Or Advil, you know, the brand name here.
Oh, that's right.
That's what Advil is. Good stuff. Good stuff.
Short for adversary villain.
So mom's still been basically on that for now for almost a whole month by now. But yeah, 3 weeks. She is getting better. As a slipped disc, it is a herniated disc, I believe is also what they're called.
Ugh.
And she was told that it was not that bad, you know, I mean, it was definitely survivable, and all she had to do is, you know, rest and maybe get some light physical exercise to help out every now and then. And she's been doing fine ever since. She's, you know, not fully out of pain, but still doing quite well.
Wow.
Once again, she is 80 years old and it will take some time. So yeah, once again, got to call 911 for the first time.
Fun.
You know, you mentioned that, or we mentioned the police line and things like that. I have called the police independently before, and I have called the gynecological doctor to say that, hey, you know, my wife's ready to have the baby and all that jazz.
Okay. All that jazz.
So I have called important numbers before, just not 911 exactly.
Something about that sounds like a child bragging. I have called important numbers.
Well, I mean, it is kind of a, yeah. Again, not everyone is calling 911 every day, but also like,
that's true.
It's kind of thing that children can accidentally do a lot.
That's true. I did
certain
as a kid.
I
was doing a prank as a kid.
Oh man.
I didn't realize the phone was plugged in.
I still
physically pressed 9-1 and then 1 again. I guess because I was committed to the bit, even though I was like across the room from the other kids and right. Like nobody could. I was at a birthday party at another kid's house.
Oh, this is even better.
I didn't know the phone was plugged in and I dialed 911. And then I just said into the receiver, hi, is this 911 pizza? I'd like two large ambulances.
I would like to ask, how old were you?
I want to say 9 or 10.
Okay.
And then I hung up, and then like 5 minutes later, we heard his mom screaming at us from upstairs. Who called 911?
Oh boy. Yeah.
And everyone was like, Alex did. And then his mom yelled at me, and then we went back to playing Mega Man 5.
Okay, great.
It's pretty good. Good stuff.
Mega Man 5? No, it's not pretty good. It's one of the weak.
I like Mega. It's fine.
It's all right.
4 is my favorite.
And 6 is even better.
The 6 was the first video game I bought with my own money.
Oh, wow. Did you keep it?
Yeah, it's
now it's boffo bucks. Yeah.
Is it really?
Oh, yeah.
I mean, I don't have the box because there was a... I think I stopped doing this, but wow, I still did it with N64 games. I think I did it with all... until the GBA.
What did you do? This sounds like something I might have done. What was it?
No, it was just a kid. It was. I treated video game boxes like they were candy wrappers. Like I would get a new game. Oh, I would tear the box away and throw it in the garbage.
Sure.
Yeah.
And a lot of people did that. A lot of kids did that.
In retrospect, it makes me feel bad.
No, I was the same way. I did it up until, N64 sort of. I did keep N64 boxes. Oh no, I did. Yeah. So N64, I started keeping those boxes.
Wow.
And then Game Boy Color and GBA and stuff. Yeah.
You got Mischief Makers?
No.
Oh.
No. Sorry.
I'll come over anyway.
All right.
All right.
And just put it on the flash cart.
I did call 911 once in Japan. 119. It's backwards. It's 119. They drive to you backwards and they wear shoes on their hands.
Uh-huh.
Because my wife woke up with very bad stomach pains.
Mm-hmm.
And she told me, and I said, well, we should call 119. And then she's like, I don't want to, but okay. So I called it. And then I just put her on the phone.
Yeah. I wish I would have called you and been like, what, did you have to call 119? I mean,
well, it was a potential.
Isn't there another number you can call?
It was a potential emergency.
Oh, you didn't like mine.
You didn't explain it as an emergency. You explained it as, her back was hurting.
I'm Alex.
That's me. There's a difference between like slow pain and imminent pain, and you did not paint a picture.
I'm sure
that
my mom would love to hear this, by the way. She does listen to the show on occasion.
Just
to hear you shitting on her situation.
I'm not. You didn't explain it well enough. I am returning this assignment with so much red pen on it. I didn't understand the situation because you explained it in your very typical casual way. You're like a living oxycodone.
And you're like a living coffee.
Yeah. Don't take us together, folks.
No.
But yeah, I put my wife on the phone with the dispatch guy And I was listening to the conversation. He was like, do you need an ambulance? She's like, yeah. Okay, what's wrong? Oh, my stomach hurts. Is it really bad? Kind of. Do you need an ambulance? No. And she just hung up.
I see.
So yeah, we called and then changed our mind, like canceling a pizza order.
So he was
yeah.
doing your bit.
Yeah. Do you really need this? No, not really.
We're very Japanese of you, Alec.
Hi.
Oh.
Good stuff.
God. Oh my goodness. Oh. Okay. Well, anyway, I was going to lead into the fact that because my mom was laid up in such a bad way, my wife and I decided to basically fast track looking for daycare for the baby.
Oh, right.
Because mom had been the go-to caregiver for him during the day.
Cool.
And we just basically started looking things up. And wouldn't you know, luck of lucks, that's not a phrase, we found a daycare that had one spot remaining open, and it was like a 5-minute drive down the road.
And oh, wow.
And also new and not terrible, you know, not like has a bad reputation or anything. Decent number of good reviews. We went ahead and decided to check that out.
Cool.
Now, a reminder, my son is not yet 1 year old.
That's true.
So, you know, it might have also been a problem for some daycares. I think they might want to have children that are a little bit older.
Right.
Closer to toddler age range. But they were totally fine taking him, taking care of him. The only problem is that the baby being at home most of the time in his life tends to just cry like a banshee.
Uh-oh.
The minute he sees another person who is not part of the family.
I'm kind of the same way.
Yeah.
I get
and
it.
And so we went to basically a quote unquote tour of the daycare, you know, just this woman's house, on a Sunday afternoon. And he is just, you know, I'm holding him and he's just crying the entire time. He cannot take this at all.
Uh-oh.
And I'm holding him. That should be enough for him to calm down. It is most other times. But here it's just like, no, this is way too strange for me. I do not know what's going on. Can I please just get the hell out of here? But the woman assured us he would most likely, based on experience, get used to it within a week.
Okay.
Probably.
Sure.
And I'll tell you, that's pretty much been the case. At first we did a week of like halftime. So he would be there from the morning until like 11 or 12 noon, and then we could take him back. But now this week, the second week, we've had him there the entire time. So like 8:30 to 5 PM. And yeah, he's gotten used to it. Smiling more, crying less. And just having fun.
Cool.
So that's sort of a, you know, good thing that came out of my mother's situation.
Okay.
And, you know, it's a plus for her. She can stay home and continue to rest and not have to completely, you know, be responsible for the baby all day or have to pick him up. Because that was the big thing, is that she was so infirm that she definitely could not lift anything else. And in fact, the doctors, of course, told her, don't lift anything now. You're healing, for God's sake.
Yeah.
So
don't even think about saying it's go time and then squatting down and trying to pick up a TV that's bolted to a stand. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, Mandelbaum. No, that's
you know, I have memories of being in a daycare like that when I was a kid. I don't have a lot of vivid memories of living in New York because we moved to Pittsburgh when I was six.
Right. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. You probably did remember some stuff.
Yeah. We moved in 89. And I have memories of preschool, which was in a church. And I remember bringing in my toys, thinking that I could just swap them for their toys.
Okay.
And my mom picked me up one day and I had a toy she'd never seen before. And we're halfway home before she's like, where'd you get that? And she's like, I took it from preschool. And she's like, you can't just take toys. I'm like, no, it's okay. I left one of mine.
take a penny, leave a penny.
Yeah, that was like that. And she's like, no. She turned around. She made me bring it back.
Wow. What a little socialist.
I know. And then I have brief memories of kindergarten where I, you know, brought in my DuckTales tape and we watched DuckTales. Right. But even before that, I have very faint memories of being in a very old woman's house with a lot of other kids.
Okay.
My mom dropped me off. I think it was only for a couple of days, too. Not consecutively, but I think maybe, I don't know what was going on, but yeah. I was just a very weird smelling house with a bunch of other kids and a very old lady.
Basically every house that's not yours, right? I mean.
Yeah, right. Even as an adult,
it's
weird, you know. I wish I had more memories of it. I also remember going to a birthday party when I was maybe five.
Mm-hmm.
At which point, I don't know who my friends are yet. I'm just, you know, this is more for the parents, really.
Yeah.
And I remember, like, I wanted to watch Nickelodeon, so I turned on their TV, and then I flipped the channel to 27, which was Nickelodeon.
Yeah.
In Ossining, New York, but wherever this birthday party was had different channels, and it was like the news or some shit, and I lost my mind. I may have started crying, wondering where Nickelodeon was and what hellscape I was now living in, where you know, today's special was replaced with today in the stock market.
Your one emotional rock that you needed that day.
Yes.
It wasn't there. Yeah.
No.
Mm-mm-mm. Okay.
Right. I can't get by if I don't watch another rerun of Pinwheel.
Right. Of course.
Right. Remember that guy who lived in the basement and grew weeds?
Barely. No.
Legalize it. Okay. That's all I remember from New York. Yeah. Also, the first dream I remember was in the dream. I woke up, I looked out the window, and I saw Mac Tonight playing piano on the moon. Over to you.
All right. Great. I was going to say, I'd never been to daycare and didn't go to preschool either.
You're missing out, man.
Look how I turned out.
Yeah. Yeah, I am. I did.
But we're doing that, of course, with our baby, and we'll probably continue to try and get him into preschool. But yeah, I just thought it was crazy that place was open and so close by, because we were looking up other places and they were all filled up, which is, you know, what you'd expect. And yeah, just feeling good. It was like a good upswing type of thing from, again, my mom's situation. Cool. So some positive stuff going on in baby world, just not mom world.
Baby world.
Yeah. So that's basically the baby update that you asked about at the beginning.
Oh,
of the
shit. Hang on. I forgot to play the theme. I'll play it now. All right. Thank you.
Great.
All right. Awesome.
That'll be his theme song. Yeah, for sure.
All right. Good. Good. I'm caught up.
Yeah. Yes, you are. And so is the listener.
Listener. They are nodding. Okay. Yeah.
I've been on spring break this week from school.
Spring break.
Still have not actually relaxed, though, because I've been trying to work on compiling math notes for an exam next week. That I hopefully do not bomb, because I need to surreptitiously put these notes on my calculator.
Math notes. What are math notes? Math was invented in the year 600.
It's extreme bullshit, because his teacher will not allow any sort of note card to be taken with you to the exam, as opposed to last year's math class, where it was totally accepted. As long as you could fit all your notes on an index card, you were good.
Right.
And I did some of that, but now I'm just like,
so a lot of scribbling in 1-point font.
Oh yeah, I did that. Oh yeah, it was really fun. Actually, I had really learned some things about myself. But yeah, it was it's rough now. It's a lot more rough, and I just trying to keep my head above water. But yeah, so to reiterate, not a great relaxing spring break, as it turns out.
Did you play any games?
No.
What?
No. I have not played one video game pretty much since the semester started.
Oh my, you're killing me here.
I know. I wanted to try Like a Dragon, but it's just like, it's way too much guilt in the back of my head.
You talk about Isshin?
Yes.
Even I played that.
I know. I'm jealous.
This is bizarre.
Yeah.
We're living in a bizarre world.
Has the whole world gone topsy-turvy?
Yes. I also played through Paranormicide. We can talk about that later.
See, I also bought that and really didn't play it either.
You gotta play. It's great.
Ah, I know.
It's spooky. It's real spooky dooky.
And then Live Alive's out on PC in 3 weeks.
Raibu a Raibu?
Ah, Jesus Christ. Too much
Atosan Shukan? Okay.
Too much fun to be had.
Too much fun to be had.
I will correct myself. I did play one game and that's been Theat Rhythm.
Okay, right. You love Theats.
Just not, you know, to any sort of completion, but I did put a good couple days into that at least. And so, yeah, that was fun.
Yeah. Maddie recommended Theat Rhythm when she visited the bar last month. And I downloaded the demo and it was fine. And then Maddie immediately recommended a Picross alike on the phone called Meow Tower. And that's all I've been playing since.
Okay.
It's just a Picross game where you solve puzzles and you buy furniture for cats, and it's really good.
You buy furniture for cats. All right.
Yes.
Fantastic.
I really enjoy it.
Boy, oh boy.
I have currently bought up all the furniture, but there's still more puzzles to do.
All right.
So I'm going to do all the puzzles so that when eventually more cats are released, I will have enough tuna cans to buy furniture for all of them. You don't understand.
And this is a one-time payment game. I mean, you pay
once.
It's
free.
Well, I meant in the sense that, you know, they're not charging you for extra furniture or anything like that. You're not buying anything in-app purchases or.
Oh, no. There's no. I mean, you can, but it's.
Oh.
You know, it's typical mobile game where, like, the way this works is you have eight pencils. And.
Every mobile game.
Yeah, right. To do a hard puzzle costs two pencils. To do an easy puzzle costs one pencil. You can hold eight. They will refill to eight. I think you get one pencil back every 15 minutes.
Right.
But I have had my pencils as high as 15.
Uh-huh.
Because you can watch ads to get more pencils.
Mm-hmm.
But if you have eight, you can't. So I got my pencils to seven, and then I watched an ad to give me eight pencils. So I had 15 pencils. It's impressive to me.
I'm impressed. Trust me.
It gets me through work. When there's no customers, it's fun. It was that and Paranormicide. I was playing that and Paranormicide pretty much all the past 2 weeks.
Did you get that on the phone?
No, that's on my Nintendo Switch.
Oh, okay.
Meow Tower's on the phone.
No, I'm saying they also port. There's a version of Paranormicide on iOS.
Oh, on the really?
Yeah.
Well, I'm not playing that.
It launched on iOS as well.
Moshi Moshi Spooks Des.
Yeah, well, whatever. I was just asking.
All right.
Yeah, so not where I'd like to be in terms of goofing off, but yeah.
No.
I wish I could be more like Alex.
Hi, everybody.
I want a hot dog.
You know what?
Do you have any Mortal Kombat stuff?
No.
Get into what?
Might as well. If you didn't play Paranormicide, I might as well just get out of the way real quick. Because I'm not typically a visual novel guy.
Mm-hmm.
Because
me neither.
A lot of them strike me as animu garbage. Let's call it.
If we stick to the strict definition of visual novel and not just what a bunch of Westerners thought an adventure game should be now. Then yeah, a lot of it is just
quality
sort of anime garbage, like you just said.
Yeah, but Paranormicide was really nice because I love. First of all, the art style is great, and I don't know if it's watercolor or what, but like all the art is beautiful. And the character design is it's still kind of anime-ish, but it's. Trying to be a little bit more realistic. I don't know if there's a term for that, but I like it. I prefer that style.
Real ame.
Real ame, that's it. beautiful.
Yeah.
And I like the story and the characters, and it's obviously there's a paranormal angle to it, but it's not so much that it's unbelievable. It's not too crazy fantasy. It's kind of based on, I think they're actual legends.
Actual legends. It does, you heard it here.
Yeah. It does. There's three or four gimmicky moments that I wish it didn't do.
Uh-huh.
There's at least two moments I can recall that were very much like, Snake, put the controller in the second controller port. Like, you didn't need to do that. It's not, it doesn't add anything. Yeah. It doesn't add anything. And you, the game doesn't, that's the thing. The game doesn't do it enough for it to make sense. It's like, why would you only do that a couple of times? Why?
Oh,
what's the point of that?
Well, even Metal Gear did that.
Yeah, that's true. But I mean, in Metal Gear, it was because that one boss could read your mind. Not every boss could read your mind.
Okay, yeah.
You know, but Paranormal Side, if it was like, and one of them doesn't even make sense. One of them involves you. One of them is like, the story doesn't progress until you manually save your game, because one of the characters is like,
what?
One of the characters is like, well, she's dead, but I've got to do something to keep her memory alive. And the only way to progress is to manually save your game. It's real stupid.
Hold the phone.
But the rest of the game is great. The rest of the game is fantastic.
Sure. Okay. That's a little much.
That's a little much. The first one, do I want to spoil the first one? Or is the game too new?
I mean, I'm generally not that big. Yeah, I don't freak out that much about spoilers. I guess just describe it in a gist sort of manner, maybe.
Okay. All right. So if you want to play Paranormal Sight, maybe this isn't even a big deal because I thought it was dumb. But the first gimmick of the game, and which really kind of set a weird expectation, because after this happened, I was like, oh, it's this kind of game. And then it wasn't. And I was like, well, then what was the point? There's a spirit that kills you if you hear its voice.
Okay.
And at the very beginning of the game, there's this storyteller who's basically like the narrator, kind of, he's just kind of introducing you to the world. And he mm-hmm. also introduces the options of the game. He says you can adjust the music and the sound effects and the voices. And he specifically says, for example, if there's a voice you don't like, you can turn the voices down to zero and you won't hear it anymore.
Great.
And this, I mean, it becomes pretty obvious early on that it's a gimmick because the game isn't voiced.
Right.
There's no voice acting. So you get to that, you get to the ghost that kills you when you hear its voice. And it's like, oh, cute. I have to go to the options and turn voice sound all the way down to zero to get past this. And that's what it is. But the game doesn't do that again.
Yeah.
I mean, that the voice thing, the voice ghost comes back later, but your voice is still, your settings are still at zero. So it's ineffectual. Like, there's no reason to turn voices back up. It's very silly, and it's very gimmicky and out of place. And I kind of wish the game was just a straight up visual novel. It didn't try to be gimmicky, because it's like, I feel like it was.
That's a fun one.
What's the term? I don't know. Fell out of place. But
want less gimmicks.
It is. Yes. The game is overall a huge recommend. I really enjoyed it.
Yeah.
And then I immediately started looking for more visual novels and was immediately disappointed because everything else is.
Yeah. I mean, I just decided to give it a go because, yeah, like you said, it looked good. Like, it looked high quality.
Yeah.
It wasn't about a whole bunch of like sicko saw murder shit. Like,
yeah. Yeah. There's also that.
Or the Nonary games. Exactly.
Yeah. I mean
not,
there
not
is
in the sense that, you know, you're trapped in all that stuff. It's like, you're actually trying to figure out a mystery, and it followed me playing the Centennial Case, which was another game Square Enix came out with last year, an adventure game. This one with full motion video.
FMV?
Yeah.
Wow.
And that one was a good romp. It was like sort of playing a Japanese drama in a sense, and like something you'd get on Netflix. People who might listen understand that there are some Japanese television shows on Netflix that are interesting and fun, and that game is sort of like that. Anyway, yeah, I was just if Square Enix makes it, it must be good. So I decided to try out Paranormal Sight. Yeah.
There are some gory deaths, but most of them either occur off screen or are just done in a very static way. It's not super, you know, graphic.
Right.
It's a little graphic, but that's what kind of makes it spooky dooky. I like it a lot. There's a couple of jump scares here and there, but not too many that you get used to them.
Yeah, spooky I'm okay with, just not, oh, these eight people are trapped in this puzzle room and some guy's going to kill it, but you also kill these people.
That's, yeah, I don't have any patience for the Saw model, which is just, I've captured a bunch of people and now we're really going to see how ugly the human is.
Yeah.
It's not, it's really not my preferred scenario.
And for some reason, you're being told this by a black and white cookie of a teddy bear.
Yeah. I bought Danganronpa because it was cheap on the Switch a while back and then immediately regretted it. Because I'm done. I'm like, I said this before, but like, I have no more patience. I never ever want to play a game where I am a Japanese high school student or any kind of high school student. I can't. I'm out. I'm done. You might say I've graduated. Yeah, a little school humor for you.
All right, then I guess you don't want to beta test my game. Go Japanese high school 3D.
No. Okay. Wait, 3D? I'm in.
Yeah, right.
All right. Cool.
With graphics. Get a load of that.
Okay. Hey, polygons.
Yeah.
Wow. But no, you know what? If it takes place in a high school, I'm polygon.
All right.
Thanks. I also like the fact that the Paranormicide switches between different storylines.
Okay.
And you can't progress some of them until others have progressed to a certain point.
You might call it a zapping system.
It's a zapping system. There's a lot of zapping going on. And one of those storylines is a couple of schoolgirls investigating ghostos. One is a couple of detectives. It's like an older senior detective and the young, fresh-faced new guy who's very excited. One of them is a kind of a middle-aged mom and a detective working together. It's really, I like all the characters.
Okay. Yeah.
Everyone's got pretty good, believable motivations. It's very well written. It's minimal typos. My tombstone only has minimal typos. towards the end of it, I started to notice a couple more typographical errors just because it's a lot of text to translate, but it's still very well translated.
Yeah.
For it. And I think it's on sale. Maybe that also helped me. I don't remember.
It launched. I mean, it, the base price is cheap to begin with. Like $20.
Yeah. Maybe that's what it was then. I just saw it. Because somebody recommended another one on the Discord.
$19.
Somebody recommended another one on the Discord and it was $40. And I'm like, there's no way I'm taking a gamble on a $40 visual novel.
Well, sometimes, you know, things are on sale on Switch as well. So it's sort of, you know, you could also just wait for it there. Maybe.
That's good because I need them on Switch.
Okay.
All
wow.
Right.
Yeah.
We did it.
That felt really good.
Yeah.
It felt like I just had a normal conversation with you. Wow.
Well, this is going to make no sense because I'm cutting out all the piss bits.
Like when people edit the laugh tracks out of sitcoms. And
yeah.
For meme videos. Yeah. Okay. All right. Well, then, shall we take a break?
Yes, please.
Shall we really have a new beginning here? Okay.
Yes, great. Please. Yes, have some.
All right. We'll be back with more of this show, whatever this is, after this.
Today's show is brought to you by EPOS Gaming Audio. With a comprehensive lineup of both wired and wireless headsets, gaming amplifiers, microphones, and webcams, EPOS has everything you need to experience the power of audio. Like their H6 Pro lineup, which features two versions, an open or closed headset. The closed headset allows you to tap into exceptionally detailed audio and seals out ambient noise, while the open version delivers natural high-fidelity audio with an incredible soundstage. Both headsets include a magnetic detachable microphone and a sleek design that has no wild RGB configurations, just good design. Listeners can save 15% by visiting www.eposaudio.com/gaming and entering code EPOSFRIEND15 at checkout.
And we're back with another great episode of...
Hold your horses, mister. This is a commercial for our show, Nasty Lamps. Not the actual show.
You mean to tell me this is a commercial for our bi-weekly show from game studio Chuhai Labs, where we talk about games, game dev, Japan, and whatever else comes up?
Yep, and it stars me, Kinsey Burke. And also it has my junior co-host, Mark Lentz.
Sup, though?
So catch brand new episodes twice monthly for only three easy payments of $420.69.
That doesn't make sense.
Nasty Labs! Only on the Tokyo Beat Network.
Folks, we're back as No More Whoppers. I'm Ray, that's Alex.
Hi, everybody.
Alex, I have a new segment.
What is it?
Well, you know, in the grand tradition of snack food copy and drink food copy, I give you normal food copy.
What's the normal food copy theme song? Wait, I have it. I want a hot dog. All right.
Yeah.
Cool.
This is... some copy I found on a basically a boxed meal, like a sort of yeah, these things around the deli at the grocery store. They sell like a packaged like pasta dish, you know.
Okay.
Good for a couple people to eat for dinner. You know what I mean? It's called Kevin's. Kevin's is the brand. It was just okay. Like Kevin's fucking what chicken pasta, whatever.
All right.
Actually, pretty good. And I will explain it to you through the copy here on the back, because it is, of course, a lovely introductory copy.
Let's do it.
In that tradition. So here we go.
The crack of the bat. Okay, go.
Eat better without sacrificing flavor. When I was in my 20s, an autoimmune disorder threw my life off balance.
Whoa!
Nothing helped consistently until I discovered a paleo-friendly diet that avoided artificial ingredients. While I was grateful to return to my everyday life, I found myself paying for guilt-free meals with boring cuisine and a lack of flavor. I made it my mission to change this. My quick-to-prepare entrees, sauces, sides, and soups make it easy to create paleo-friendly meals at home that taste so good you feel like you're cheating. Enjoy! Signed, Kevin.
Signed, Kevin. P.S. Buy more!
Yeah.
I love how a lot of the food copy, especially when it's a person's name attached to a brand, 9 times out of 10, it's just, I grew up boring, but then I thought, what if food could be delicious?
Right. Yeah.
I fucking...
this is really the journey I'm on here in these segments. Yeah. Well, to Kevin's credit, it was good.
Okay.
Yeah, it was the whole shebang. It was chicken and pasta and sauce. You just... you know, in a bag, you
all
put
right.
it in the microwave or whatever. Yeah, it's all
is
good.
Is this a tomato-based sauce?
I believe so.
All right, I'm not a big fan, but I'll allow it.
You know, it was a couple of weeks ago at this point, but yeah, still pretty good. Wow. There was also a beef stroganoff.
Cool.
That was good for a packaged beef stroganoff because, again, this came from the grocery store deli section. The grocery store makes their own beef stroganoff. It sucked. Terrible.
Yeah. Oh my God. I can commiserate because we live, we moved next door to a Don Quixote, which has a giant supermarket, which also makes its own stuff, okay. Which also sucks.
Okay. Yeah. I would guess the Don Quixote wouldn't have the best food that they're making there.
It's, yeah. But
other
like
than, you
everything
know,
else,
a box of crackers or whatever.
Everything else about the supermarket, like it seems like a fancy schmancy supermarket.
Okay.
It's a new construction. It seems, I don't want to say ritzy, but it feels a little more upscale than a typical Japanese supermarket.
But sometimes that doesn't mean anything because,
yeah,
you know, when I lived by myself in Burlingame those years ago, they just opened the brand new Safeway, renovated, completely new Safeway with freaking parking on the roof and everything. But nothing exciting as far as the deli stuff goes. And we talked about this, I'm sure. Their sandwich is still blando.
Calrissian. Oh.
Dryo. just nothing. And in fact, the sandwiches were made worse once they had like some sort of partnership with the Boar's Head company to make these sandwiches that had like added onions to them and everything, and just ruined them completely. And so I'm just,
what?
Like, you know, not good, not great, you know, down there at Safeway.
You know what I do miss? I was talking to somebody at the bar about this last night, but just the thing I miss most, there's not a lot I miss about America. There's not a whole lot to love, really. But one of the things I do miss is an honest to goodness roast beef deli sandwich that's just piled high with roast beef, lettuce, tomato, and horseradish sauce. I do have fond memories of just a big tube of Boar's Head horseradish sauce. Slather that on a sandwich.
Okay, yeah.
I just miss having a giant deli sandwich. It's not the kind of thing you can really get in Japan.
Wow. It's crazy. Maybe that can be your next venture.
No, I even asked the meat guy.
Okay.
There is a service. There's a guy called the meat guy who I believe operates in the Chubu region, who like his whole business is he imports meat to Japan and sells it mostly to foreigners. Like if you need half a cow, he'll get you half a cow.
Okay.
I even emailed him. I'm like, hey, I'm opening a bar. I want to have panini sandwiches. What do you like? What, how can I source like deli meats? And he's like, not really. It's not cost effective because there's just not enough demand for it.
At that point, you have to get a slicer and cook it
yourself.
Yeah,
exactly. Yeah. And I'm like, okay, well, that's not, you know, I'm not a restaurant.
The cooking would come before the slicing, by the way. I just want to make sure everybody understands.
Wait, really?
Yeah. You don't.
Hang on. I dropped
something. Fell in the background.
Yeah.
Out of your shock at this.
It's also, I'm glad my new mic, not new, I'm glad my mic can pick that up.
Right. Yeah.
I play with my wedding ring a lot. I fidget. Uh-huh. I fiddle, you know.
You're a fiddler.
I am a fiddler. Not on the roof.
Yeah. No.
We did that in high school.
Right.
I played the French horn.
So once again, Kevin's Natural Foods, Paleo Chicken Pasta Primavera with cauliflower pasta. Pretty good. The copy, a little weird, but yeah. All right. As a matter of fact, I'll tell you what, you can go to their website and they have photos of the front and back of the package. So you too, ooh, listener, can go and read the normal food copy I just presented to you today.
Oh.
Which is very funny. You usually don't see photos of the back of the food package like it's GameStop or something.
Used?
Yeah.
What the? This gnocchi is refurbished?
I really need to see this description. I need to know what kind of game I'm getting into.
Wow.
All right. So that's normal food copy. Thank you for listening.
Pretty good. Thank you very much. Let's all say thank you, Kevin. Thank you, Kevin. All right.
I still don't actually know what a paleo diet really is.
I think it's when you eat rocks.
I understand it means paleolithic, of course, but
yeah.
Caveman somebody, diet. But
yeah. Somebody on my Twitch stream suggested it's when you just eat Fruity Pebbles, which really made me laugh.
Okay.
Yeah. It turns out for a couple of years in college, I was doing paleo.
Well, side story, I also picked up at the grocery store keto cereal. This is like what the hell is the cereal? Oh, Trix. It's like knockoff Trix, but keto style.
It's called Pranks with an X.
The wildest thing I've ever experienced. The cereal tasted better dry.
Ugh.
Once I added milk to the thing, it became just this flavorless mess that I did not want to eat. And this is one of those cereals that's like Magic Spoon, you know, one of these sort of podcast advertisement cereals.
Yeah.
Same sort of deal, different brand, not Magic Spoon exactly, but it's just like, I'll just stick to the name brand sugar packed stuff. Thanks. I'm not on the diet anyway, so I think I'll live. But yeah, that was just one of those things.
I'm on my oatmeal diet. It's pretty good.
Oh yeah, I bet.
Just eating oatmeal. Well, I mean, for breakfast.
Oats and honey?
Yes.
Yeah, that's right.
I got some helpful feedback from our pal Gabe Glick, a video game translator who lives in Okazaki.
All right.
Who pointed me towards a bulk oatmeal purchase on the internet.
Wow.
Which I think I'm going to take part in.
You still keep in touch?
Yeah.
Cool.
He's a listener of the show.
Oh.
Yeah.
I didn't know.
That's right.
All right.
Yeah, he knew almost instantly the package of oatmeal I was talking about, the big red canister. Mm-hmm. And pointed me towards a bulk option, which I think I'm going to do because I'm going through oatmeal real quick.
Yeah, I bet.
You know?
Fabulous, yes.
Just a big fan. And we finally live in a place now where we have storage space. We have a whole storage closet. So, I could fill it with oatmeal. I'm going to open the door. Oatmeal's going to pour out. My wife's going to get angry.
Slow down, cowboy.
What? Oh, that would be fun, though.
Have you broached this with your wife?
What? Not yet.
You're like, why?
No, I mean, we still have plenty of room in the storage closet because we just moved in. All that's in there is an old TV, some boxes, carpet, and that's about it.
All right.
And a Wii Fit balance board.
Oh, of course. I've been trying to sell mine. It's been languishing on eBay.
Oh, so you don't want to buy week. You don't want to buy mine?
I don't know.
Do I want to buy yours?
No. I did pressure wash it to get all the gunk out of the middle crevice.
Oh, good.
Yeah. So at least, you know, I take care of my stuff.
You do.
I provide a good used product, but that's people true. Aren't biting.
Oh, man.
Yeah, it sucks.
Are there any other uses for the Wii Fit balance board?
No, not like obvious or easy to do or fun. Okay. No.
There's not like a game studio that's developing for a VR headset and like they can only get this certain effect by testing it out on a Wii balance board.
I'm afraid not. I mean, Punch Damn Out it. Supports it. You can play Punch Out with it.
That's right.
Yeah. There's some other games that might be marginally interesting that support it, but yeah, otherwise no.
All right. That's fine.
It would be if you asked me, hey, is there anything I can do with this Kinect? And I'd be like, well, some students 10 years ago did some research projects with it, but not like a fun thing you can do. No.
Damn it. I do have a Kinect I don't need either.
Yeah, right.
Man.
Tell me about it.
I just did.
You don't have more? Okay.
I got bar talk. Let's talk bar stuff.
All right. Bar talk.
Yes, I got a very nice visit from legacy listener Gwerk and Mrs. Gwerk, who are in Japan.
What does legacy listener mean?
He was a listener of my podcast before this.
Oh, okay, right.
With that I did with a local guy. Yes, much like Gabe Glick was even on that show.
Yeah.
Yeah, so yeah, Gabe's a legacy. He's a legacy hire.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, it was really cool to meet them. They came into the bar for a little visit. We hung out. It was very fun. This week I got a visit from Phil, who is a new listener, but he's the brother of JT, a dude who used to live in Nagoya.
Okay.
JT used to visit the bar with his wife, Brianna. Hi, Bri. I don't know if they listen, but hi. Phil's a cool dude. Came for a couple of days. We talked games and movies, and it was just real nice. But it's real nice to engage with people our age because right. I did have last Saturday, I did have a group of, like 7 or 8 students who were very nice, but also like very early 20s, not a whole lot of life experience, not a whole lot of, commonalities
because the drinking age is lower in Japan. Right?
They were from America, though. They were studying abroad.
But still in Japan, though. But I mean,
yes.
You could be 20 and still go to a Japanese bar.
That's true.
Yeah.
I did. I started drinking at 20 because I was over here at Chubu. Started drinking at a place called Sanmaru, which is an izakaya chain where it's called Sanmaru because everything is 300 yen.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Not related to Sanrokumaru, the Xbox 360.
No, we were living in a pre-360 world. Pre-60, I call it. Yeah. Wow.
Before the HD era?
That's right.
Wow.
Yeah. High def, high don't.
Ghost Recon? Go ahead.
Yes, thank you. I was I was reading up on, Ghost Recon means ghost divorce. Do you think that's a game?
Yeah. Hey, guess what? There's a high chance it won't take place in a high school. So
no. Yeah, that's true. I go more in depth about the YouTube video I'm trying to make on our bonus show, Golden 16 Seconds, out soon.
Right.
And I have been reading. I didn't know that there was a name for the sort of modern pixel style called high bit. Have you heard of this term?
No. Can I tell you? I already don't like it.
Yeah. I guess it's sort of a term. I mean, it's a necessary.
Who's coming up with this? Who's doing this?
It was cited in the paper as being used, I think, by the who's the developer of Sea of Stars. They interviewed the developer of Sea of Stars about their previous game, which was EastEnders. Was that them? What's their game? I don't remember.
I don't know.
But the term high bit came up as a general term to mean pixel graphics that you wouldn't actually see on a retro console, but can only be done sort of on modern technology. I think we do need a term to denote that. I don't know if it should be high bit instead of,
I would argue maybe one not so neutral, yeah, or positive.
Yeah. High bit sounds like a Japanese rail pass app you put on your phone.
Sure.
I don't know. You got to load it up with money to ride the train.
I'm just kidding, because there are plenty of games that I think fall under that I've enjoyed. I think Sonic Mania fits that.
Oh, really?
I would say so. Shovel Knight even, right?
Okay. No. Well,
not to like the strict other end of the spectrum that I think Sea of Stars would be at, but
I think that's what it's for, though. I think Shovel Knight is pretty clearly like 8-bit style.
Okay.
Even though it does have a couple of flourishes that you couldn't do on an NES, but I think it is still supposed to like focus on that style.
I definitely do not want to split hairs about it, but
no,
just because I'm not that interested.
Okay,
but please, you can keep going with what you were reading about.
I mean, I'm kind of not that interested either. It was nice to see a term to talk about something that I know that I'm not a fan of, because I'm specifically interested in the impact of like 8 and 16 bit sprites,
sure,
of their time, and like why were they so evocative? Why were they so powerful to us, or to me specifically? And yeah, you know, why does a sprite made in 1994 for a Super Famicom game 10 times more like potent and evocative than a quote unquote high bit sprite made for an indie game today? You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, it's because you and I have agency and
that is true.
And experience, and are not easily swayed by shiny things in front of our face.
That's true. All right. I talk more about that on the bonus show. I can't tip my hand here. Here's what I will talk about.
Here's what I will tip.
I'll take a tip. I take tips. Yeah. Some folks do tip me at the bar, which is nice.
Okay, good.
Certainly not necessary expected.
Not acceptable in that culture.
No. I did have 8 German guys come in a couple of Saturdays ago, because apparently there was some kind of sporting event in town. It was either soccer or rugby or something.
It's the 8-man rumble.
The 8-man scrum? Is that a rugby thing?
Yes, let's go with that.
Okay. All right. I had a lot of Germos come to the bar. They were very nice.
Well, oh, the Germans. Yeah. No, I thought you meant sick people.
No. Two of them actually overslept and missed the game. They came to Japan to watch.
Wow.
But they were kind of, they were good natured about it. They were laughing it off. Like, it's fine. We're still vacationing in Japan. We're having a good time.
Of course.
That was fun.
Why would you not? Right.
Yeah. That was fun, but it was also extremely, like, it caught me by surprise, because I really, really do not like huge groups coming into the bar without notice, because I fall into anxiety mode.
Yeah.
That's
plus
why
they're German.
Well, that's fine.
Okay. Oh, okay.
I like to have notification, though, if you're going to be more than 4 people. Fortunately, it was right when I opened. It was like right after 5 p.m., so there was nobody in the bar. So.
Uh-huh.
I hate it when I fucking I see the door open and a string of people comes in with just no end in sight. What? It's like a reverse clown car. Is there an opposite to the clown car? It's like that.
It's well, the like clown car can be outside the outdoors, right? Is that what you guess? Yeah. Right.
The out of doors.
Yeah.
I guess it's so much anxiety. Like after the sixth or seventh person, I just kind of throw my hands up and I'm like, how many people do you have? Like, could you not have called ahead for fuck's sake? And it turned out to be eight guys and they were fine. They were very nice, but also, you know, a little bit of consideration would be nice.
And these people had never heard of the bar, right? Or other than maybe
that's the thing is a lot of people just find it by searching Google Maps, or they just literally type into Google, good bars in Nagoya. And then they find mine and they see that it has a decent rating and they're like, oh, I'll go here with my seven friends. There's 14 chairs. Can you not? I mean, I like that you're here. Can you make a reservation?
In some ways, though, that's just the I don't want to say a necessary evil, but it's like one of those things that's just going to happen because people think bar.
Yes.
They think of the bars where they're from.
Yes.
It's like, oh, we can fit a whole group in here. We can go to the pool table. We can have a nice drink. We can. Maybe go have another chat over by the jukebox, you know, like
that. That has been one of the major frustrations of having a bar in Japan, is because people visiting Japan don't understand that Japan has thousands of just small bars.
Yeah.
And they think they can just roll up with a van full of people and get seats. Like, you can't, you have to make a reservation if you're going to do that. Or even what's even worse is people who roll in with a big group and they think they're going to a barcade. They think that's what it is. And they open the door. I guess they go into the basement of a small building and open the door, expecting it to just be a decommissioned airplane hangar full of arcade machines. Like, that's not what it fucking is.
You never know in magical Japan.
Look at literally any of the photographs on the internet of the bar. It's not a barcade. You can't bring your birthday party here.
Oh,
there. Like I said, there are 14 chairs and I don't like people standing. So like if you don't fit, fuck off.
I was going to bring my birthday party. I mean, it's just a couple people. It's really just me and my wife, I think, would just
That's
be
fine.
There. And,
Two is fine. Okay.
All right.
Two is fine.
Okay, so you're fine with the number of people.
Back it up. You're not inviting your son to your own birthday party?
I don't think he wants to be at a bar.
What?
Yeah.
But I got Dino Ricky.
You still have people?
Yeah.
Yeah, no, it's not going to fly.
Oh, right. Okay. It's fine. But I just
a little exasperation there.
I think I also need to start taking deposits on reservations because I had a this went bad on me twice. Once in December, I think it might have even been Christmas Eve.
Yeah.
Somebody made a reservation for eight people. It was a Japanese guy.
Uh-huh.
Made a reservation for eight people and then just did not show. And when you make a reservation for eight people in a place with only 14 chairs, that's more than half the room that I had to close off.
Yeah.
Like I had to turn away people and I had to tell them, no, sorry, all of this is reserved for a group. And then they just fucking did. Like I started messaging the guy at like the reservation was eight for eight. It was eight people at 8 o'clock. And I messaged at like 8:02. And I didn't say, where are you? I just said, Yoroshiku onegaishimasu. And then at about 8:10, I was like, I'm going to hold this reservation for another 20 minutes and then it's gone. And they never got back to me. That was the last message I sent them. I'm no longer accepting reservations from this person. Sure. And then after what happened last month, I think I need to start taking deposits because I had another reservation for eight.
Too many flakes.
Reservation for eight people at 10 p.m., which is fine, but this was also the night of the German invasion.
Okay.
Yeah. And the German invasion
maybe
was...
Maybe not call it that?
Why? What's wrong? Is it something wrong?
A little loaded.
The German dudes were unannounced, but they came in early. They came in at, you know, 5 p.m., and I told them straight up, like, look, we got 5 hours, but I have a group of eight coming at 10 p.m.
Yeah.
And they were very understanding. and they ended up leaving around 10 p.m. They were there for a while. They drank a lot. They were great guys.
Okay.
They could have stayed another hour to drink more, and I could have made another hour's worth of money because the group right. that made the reservation didn't show up till 11. And to the guy's credit who made the reservation, he was constantly texting me the whole time being like, we're going to be late. Sorry, it looks like 10:30. Sorry, it looks like 10:45. Sorry, it looks like 11.
Just said, well, nah.
Right.
Shrug.
And they did eventually show up, which is good. However, I cleared the room for them to be there at 10. The bar works on a time system. It's one drink or 500 yen per hour, and that's up to you. I think what I have to do is just start taking a 10,000 yen deposit. The clock starts ticking for the time you made the reservation at. So if you made a reservation for eight people at 10 p.m. and you roll in at 11, that's like I'm already getting 4,000 of those yen.
Right.
Because you said 10, you said eight people. Where are you? You know?
Yes.
So yeah, I think that's the new thing is we're only doing reservations with a 10,000 yen deposit.
All right.
Yeah, I don't have the fucking patience for people anymore. And don't even get me started on jackasses breaking my Super Famicoms. I had to make a Twitter post about this.
I did see this very
Jesus fucking Christ.
It's very charged tweet you sent there.
Yeah, it's weird though because it's like it's like the Predator meme with Carl Weathers and Schwarzenegger, you know, gripping arms where the left is boomers and the right is zoomers and the middle is not knowing how a fucking Super Famicom works. Because that's who's doing this. That's who it's always it's one of those two. You're either too young or too old to fucking know what this machine is. And it fucks me up.
Fascinating, really. I mean, people just. Well, you know, it's Nintendo's fault. They shouldn't have designed it that way.
But, like, that's the frustrating thing is I see it. By the time I see it happen, it's too late because I see it happening from across the bar. I see somebody stand up and put both thumbs on the eject button and lean on it with their entire weight. And then I see them say something to their friends like, it's stuck. I don't know. It's not coming out. What's wrong with it? And then I have to shout across the bar, stop.
Wow.
And then they tend to back off. And I have to then very gruffly explain, you have just broken a Super Famicom. Please stop this.
Yeah, it would seem like such a natural assumption. I know people are drinking and may lose some of their deductive function.
Yeah.
But you still would think like maybe the thing would let you do what you want once it's all powered down because it actually has like a physical switch there that unlatches the deal the thing. Is. Yeah.
I don't understand it. It's like even the youngest people who play video games these days. Maybe not. I was going to say, like, even the youngest people played a Game Boy Advance, which was, you turn it off, you take the game out, you put another game in, you turn it on. Even though there's not a physical latch keeping it in there, but you knew that's what you do. But I guess with
even
the DS. And the,
The original DS, if you just popped the thing out while it was running, you've crashed it. You ruined it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. Well, I'm done yelling at people who frustrate. And in fairness, this only happened 3 times over 8.5 years.
Yeah.
Like I don't want to make it seem like all three of these happened in the span of a month. This was, but it was like the third time is the one that made me say, okay, I really can't afford this happening again. I just don't, it's bizarre. It's why are you doing this?
Yeah. Wow.
Or even it, like, you know, these machines are old. If you think something's not working, why don't you just say, excuse me, I don't know how this works, or excuse me,
that.
I think it's... Yeah.
There's also that. There's a guy who runs a place who would probably help you out.
I am happy to help. I'm very genial before things are broken.
Yeah.
Let's remember
before you
this.
Ruin my shit. I'm quite happy to help you not ruin my shit.
My universal approach to customer service is and has always been... I am super nice to you until you give me a reason not to be.
Yeah, well, of course, yes.
And one of those reasons is breaking a fucking Super Famicom.
Yeah, yeah. Just
I try to be very nice. I try to be accommodating.
Yeah.
Let me tell you about an experience that I thought was going to annoy me and then turned out to be the opposite.
Okay.
I was closing up on a Friday night. I was starting to close up. It was 11:30, which is typically when I do last call.
Right. Friday night and the time is right.
That's right. And the door, I think I'm talking to two of my regulars or something as I'm trying to close up. And then the door opens and I see a just very drunk guy who's like, "Are you still open?" And I just really want to say no. But and before I can say anything, he says, "We've been trying to come here for days." And I'm like, well, now I feel bad.
We've been wandering the streets.
We've been camping on the hallway. How did I miss you? So I'm like, okay, but it's last call. So I'll give you one. And he's like, okay. So he brings in three friends and it's the four of them. And my patience are tested because I want to go home. And I have no patience for drunk people. And then he says, it's my birthday and I really wanted to visit. I'm like, okay, cool. So I get everybody a drink.
No, that was me.
And what? Oh, happy birthday. and he is, also he is from Quebec. So he's got like a pretty thick, drunk Quebecois accent.
Okay.
And he's like, yeah, it's my birthday and I like retro games. And I'm like, okay, cool. What do you what kind of games do you like? And he's like, oh, you probably don't know about it, but I'm really into this old RPG called Suikoden. And I'm like, go on, my friend. What else are you into? I really like Xenogears and Final Fantasy VI. I kind of missed when Final Fantasy was turn-based. I sure wish FF7 wasn't an action game. Tell me more, my good sir. I'm suddenly this man's best friend. Yeah, I'm I am suddenly this drunk man's best friend, and we talk. It got to the point where his friends were trying to leave.
Wow. Yeah.
I want to talk to this guy more about classic RPGs, and his friends are like, "Hey, man, we really got to get last train." And I brought down my Suikoden 1 and 2 protagonist figures from the top of the shelf. So I let him take a birthday picture with both of them.
Okay.
Just very cool. It was really
celebrity
nice.
Celebrity photo.
Yes. Oh, man. Where are they now? Well, back on my shelf. It was just a really it's nice to meet a classic RPG fan of the same mind.
I'm with you.
I'm getting tired of I'm not the only person, but. I feel like there should be more retro RPG nerds who are kind of frustrated with the direction Final Fantasy is taking. You know what I mean?
Yes. Uh-huh. Where are they?
Nice to meet someone who knows retro RPGs and is able to talk about them even when he is very drunk.
Yeah.
Speaking of breaking, still need to hand my Dreamcasts off to my buddy Mike so he can have a look at them because I don't want to have to buy new Dreamcasts.
Yeah. Or find a new mic.
I talked about that. No, I love that mic. I talked about my Dreamcasts, I think last episode, how the first controller port on one of them is just straight up not working.
Right.
It's not great.
And I tried to give you an overview of what might be the problem, because that is a common problem.
It is, and thank you for that.
Yeah. I mean, I didn't really help, but...
Did you know that Scott Aukerman collects limited edition consoles?
Give me your SNL Dreamcast.
All right, that's that's Rayman. That's
it's
all
a
I
cartoon.
Got
it's a fantasy land.
Thank you.
I'm asking you to go to the kitchen, pull out a knife, and jam it into your fucking gut.
That's all I got for bar talk. I meant to mention this like three episodes ago, but
all right,
somebody sent me a Christmas card from Switzerland.
All right. Land of chocolate.
That's right. It was.
No, that was Germany.
The
German guys.
Yeah, from an Alexander Barr, which by the way was the original name of Critical Hit.
Yes. No. In Japanese parlance, would be Barr Alexander.
That's true. Yes. A beautiful Christmas card. What looks to be a glossy photo taken with a Game Boy camera of a Nutcracker. It's all right. Very nice. I appreciate it. It's very possible that I know this person under their online pseudonym. because I don't know that I know an Alexander Parr, but Alex, get back to me and help me thank you properly, because I really enjoyed it and I feel bad for not having said anything until now. Thanks. And Merry Christmas to you.
Optimus.
Okay, no, there we go. Yes, I finally thought to search my email. We have corresponded with Alex in the past, but thank you again. Anyway, that is now all from me for Bar Talk. All right. Raymond, over to you.
All right, time to talk about my bar.
That's right. Bar and Holt.
Hey, pretty good. man, though, I have not much else to talk about, although, you know, like I said, I've been thinking about some video games to play, but it hasn't really happened.
I've tried to play that Resident Evil 4 remake, and every time I do, my eyes get, I get very bad headaches. Eye aches, my eyes just start to pound, and I have to stop playing.
That's so weird. But hold on, we can make this a little bit of a segment.
The new version of a game called
Resident Evil.
Yes!
I only played the demo. I don't plan on buying the game for a little while until it goes on sale or something, because I don't need to play it that badly. In fact, here's my dirty little secret. I never finished the original version.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
Especially when you consider the fact that writing a little strategy guide, a short introductory strategy guide for that game, was probably the catalyst to getting me hired at 1UP and then moving to San Francisco and then staying here in California and eventually marrying and having a child.
Would you consider yourself a West Coast elite?
At this point, yeah, sure. Why not?
All right.
Yeah.
Cool. I would also consider you that.
I'm like a walking sanctuary city.
It's pretty. What's that?
It's a thing you would also criticize elites about.
Okay.
Yeah.
Cool. Yeah.
Try to keep up with right wing insanity.
I can't. I don't. I won't.
No, it's fine.
I've tried to start up RE4 a couple of times, and every time, I play until my eyes hurt, and then I get killed, and then I'm just like, not
what
today.
What is it, you think? Is it just a brightness thing?
No. I mean, well, partially, I think it's the lack of brightness, because it's everything's very... it's a lot of squinting Flynn. it's a lot of it's a lot of dark environments, and it's a lot of just my eyes aren't good at tracking movement. You know, that's one of the reasons I favor turn-based RPGs to action games, is like my eyes don't track movement very well. So I can't, but I love RE4.
You just can't.
So I think what I'm gonna do, this is what I did with RE2 remake, RE3 remake, and RE8 is, and I enjoyed them a lot, start on the easiest difficulty and then work up, because all these games do New Game Plus.
Yeah.
So typically what I'll do is I'll play through on easy, and then I'll play through on normal, and then I'll play through on hardcore or whatever, then I'll play through on Inferno or whatever.
Uh-huh.
Although RE8's the only one where I could not clear the highest difficulty, Village of Shadows, because of that stupid Heisenberg fight.
Because
that's the one fight in the game where you don't get to use any of your cool unlockables because you're stuck in a little tank.
Oh, man.
Yeah. And it's tough. It's rough.
Not good.
It's real tricky-dicky.
I guess I did play a little bit of video game, so I did try and peck away once more at the original version, because I have been playing it on PC for a couple of years now. And I'm farther than I ever was in my past. So, you know, I'm getting ever closer to fighting Krauser finally.
Oh, wow.
But yeah, it's just like, God damn, that game is long. It just keeps throwing all sorts of different, I guess, not gimmicks, to borrow your phrase from earlier, but just like, you know, situations. And it just keeps going and going.
Yeah.
It's a real toy box of bullshit.
It is.
Good, fun bullshit. But
it's fun. Although, I watched my buddy Tom last night clear what is infamously considered one of the more difficult rooms in the game. Just the big waterfall room.
We're still talking about the remake.
I mean, the room is in both versions, and it's annoying in both versions.
Right, but your friend.
Yeah, remake.
Yeah, okay.
Yes, it's boy. But he did it. Yeah. Come on over, let's play.
Yeah, sure. I'll get right on it.
All right. You're on the plane now?
As long as I don't have to buy it, that's fine. Yeah.
No, you can play my copy.
Yeah, I know.
All right.
Do it. Fine.
All right.
Jesus Christ.
We'll order pizza.
Good.
Domino's has a big New Yorker now.
All right.
It's really good.
Isn't that Pizza Hut?
I don't. That's wait, pizza. Can you copyright the name Big New Yorker?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure you can, yeah.
Because the
you probably don't want to mess with your competition in such a way.
Domino's Japan has a Big New Yorker.
Oh, okay.
Interesting.
Do they use the same logo?
Is
it? Insignia for it.
Yeah, the Twin Towers on fire.
Nice. Lovely.
No? Is it?
That's really good.
The joke is it would be a horrible business move. It's a good pizza. It's a good thin crust, cheesy pizza. It's honestly, it's the closest thing I think to like an acceptable American pizza I've had from a chain.
Sure.
In Japan.
Of course. Yeah. Did we have Domino's? I had, Pizza Law.
Probably.
Pizza and Alky's.
That's right.
I don't recall Domino's specifically, but
those are the ones I tend to avoid because Domino's is the cheaper option.
Of course, yeah, right. That makes sense.
Although they've started doing this thing where so they no longer okay, there used to be a coupon code.
Uh-huh.
That my buddy Tom gave me.
Here we
bless
go
his heart. This is post Pizza Loop after they stopped doing the coupons.
Yes, but your saga with Domino's coupons in general is just funny.
Oh, it's ongoing.
Yeah, right.
There was a coupon code you could plug in when you check out online, and it was just 50% off your whole order every time. And they never ask for the coupon, and they always accepted it.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's a loss leader right there.
Yeah, that's why we always got Domino's. And then they revamped their online store. The coupon no longer works.
Oh, yeah.
And I think they realized that by doing that, they were going to lose a lot of business.
Okay.
So at the same time, they were also really trying to push their app, which sucks, by the way.
Yeah. Nothing's a surprise so far.
It's one of those apps where like I downloaded it on my iPad and it's like it's one of those apps that's just at half resolution until you tap a thing and then it gets blown up. You know what I mean? Like there's no separate iPad version. Yeah.
Yeah
there's
right.
no separate tablet version. It's
iPhone
just
only. Yeah.
Yeah. So you got to tap a thing to make it blow up and
who
make it.
Who would ever want
kind of
to order food from an iPad? Bizarre.
Oh, I got another complaint about that later.
Okay, great.
But like, yeah, I, if I'm ordering on the internet.
Yeah.
I would rather just sit down at my computer with my wife, click on some things. Bing, bang, boom, it's done.
Bing, bang, boom.
And I sit down and I click on some things. And now I guess, yes, because Domino's knows they're losing business by nullifying this previously infinite coupon. So what they did was they just kind of give you, they silently give you a 50% off coupon in your virtual coupon box.
Okay.
And it'll just replenish after a while. Like if you haven't bought anything for a while, you'll get an email that's like, oh, coupons appeared in your coupon box.
I see.
Okay. And I've had one sitting there for a while, and I'm like, all right, fine, let's use it. So I go, I get on the computer. I do a little clicky-click. I ask my wife, what do you want? She says, the huge. She likes small stuffed crusts with pepperoni jalapenos.
Yeah. Alex, I do want to interject for 1 second.
Hi. Yes, go.
We'll get back to the rest of your order in just a minute. I did go to the Domino's English website, looked up their menu. They do have a category for pizzas called New Yorker.
Oh,
but not the Big New Yorker.
Hang on. Oh,
which I believe is the trademark.
That's right. I'm going to bring up dominoes.jp.
Yeah.
Are you looking at America or Japan?
No, JP.
Oh,
that's what I meant. Their English version of that.
Oh. Huh. Then maybe it is. Hang on. Wait.
And under that heading, they have the Quattro New Yorker and the Big Pepperoni.
The Big Pepperoni.
But this is under a category heading called New Yorker.
Okay. I guess there's no big then. It's just New Yorker.
No.
I saw a prefix. I saw a word where big should have been. I thought it was Big New York. Because yeah. I got the Quattro New Yorker last time.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. There
New Yorker. Oh, yeah. You're right. New Yorker. Quattro New Yorker. Oh, right. Okay. There's the Big Pepperoni and the Big Cheese, which are versions of the New Yorker. And I guess my mind put them together as Big New Yorker.
Yeah.
Shit, I won't. But look how expensive they are, man.
I know.
$38.60.
I mean, my favorite place is Roundtable Pizza. They've always hovered around that price for as long as I've known them. So
yeah,
almost doesn't faze me comparatively. But yes, I understand it is insane.
It's so much. Okay. But yeah, I got the Quattro. What did I get? The big Quattro? The Quattro New Yorker.
Uh-huh.
I go to the website, put those in our pizza basket or whatever. And then I go to the coupon box. I find the 50% coupon. I add it to the order. And I get an error message that says, this coupon cannot be used on this device.
Okay.
Which is not something I've ever seen before when ordering pizza.
Right.
The first thing I said was, what? And then the second thing I said was, no, what?
Uh-huh, right.
Like, you guys want business, right? What's going on? And I click on a little thing at the bottom of the error message that says it's information on how to download the Domino's app.
Mm-hmm.
And that you can use the coupon through the app. So I very exasperatedly went over to my room, found my iPad, opened it up, downloaded the Domino's app, logged in, put in the exact same order, added the coupon, and then we were good to go.
That's truly insane.
But yeah, the whole time I'm hemming and hawing, and my wife is just like, it's fine, we're going to have pizza. And I'm like, it's the principle of the thing. I shouldn't have to download a stupid app to give them money.
Yeah. What the hell?
But I guess you're right. I guess if it's such a loss leader, I guess that what they want in exchange is they want that app's hooks in me.
Yeah.
Well,
yeah.
There you go. So now I'm on the app, you dumbos.
Uh-huh.
Dominoes, I call it. You like that?
More like stupid hut.
More like pounds table. No? More like sloppy johns. More like pizza butt.
He is sloppy.
Yeah, right.
He's very sloppy.
Hang on. Pizza butt, little sneezers? Because they sneeze on their pizza.
Lack of sneeze guarders.
Lack of sneeze guard. God, that's one of those like names that people make up to try to be derogatory, but they're so bad that they just make other people confused.
Yes.
Like, I don't know if you knew anybody who used to refer to, like, there's some names where it's like, buddy, I agree with you, but that's stupid.
Okay, what's going on?
I don't know if you knew anybody who referred to, I knew several people who referred to George W. Bush as a shrub.
Because he's
the smaller Bush. And I'm like, is that even an own in any sense? Is that a joke?
That was the explanation? I didn't even really know that.
Like, I know you're trying to be derogatory, but there's better way. Like, I don't know. You call him a fuckface? How about, I don't know.
Right.
Shrub is like, it sounds like you've censored something that you can't say in front of a group of kids. So you have to call him shrub. It sounds like, well, okay, but what's your real insult, though?
It's the same as, and really almost sounds the same as, drumpf.
Yeah, it's one of those. Yeah, it's like, yeah, wow, got him.
Yeah, yeah.
Wow, you really stuck it to him this time.
Yeah.
It's such a half-assed thing. It's like, it's better if you don't do that. It makes you look like less of a petulant child. Just, you know, call him what his name is and then let the facts speak for themselves about how he's a human fuck-up. I hate, like, half-assed put-downs like that. Like, just don't even bother if they're going to suck.
Well, it is a real hallmark of people who basically have no sense of humor and basically just read the newspaper all day too obsessively and then expect you to care about half of the things that go on.
It is a hallmark.
I just watched The Daily Show. That's all I did.
Okay. Yeah. Anyway, what I'm saying is,
let's go, Brandon.
So stupid. Be creative with your put downs. Know what I mean?
All right.
No.
You pinhead.
Oh, jeez.
See, the funny part is that your head's quite large.
Hey, I just watched that Seinfeld episode last night with James Spader. Where you got some of your drops from.
Right. And was there any bad ADR in that?
No.
You can talk about today.
I don't think there was.
Okay.
There was some bad ADR in a previous episode, but I don't remember which one.
Uh-huh. Right.
But no, yeah.
No!
Stretching out the head, stretching out the neck hole of James Spader's sweater.
Yes.
Yeah. But some bad Seinfeld ADR that did pop in my head the other day was Elaine's Woody Woodpecker laugh. Do you remember that?
Somewhat. I think, have thought it was ADR.
Oh, it is. It's poor ADR.
All right.
I think it's here after we go. She wins the tickets for Mr. Pitt by recognizing that the song. And then I think she's leaving Jerry's apartment and like she's already going out the door. So her mouth is not visible.
It's like a segue into the next scene.
Yeah.
It was some sort of bridge sound into the.
Yeah. They just kind of sloppily edited in ADR of her going, ha 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 ha.
Yeah. I do remember that.
Yeah.
I still wouldn't have really thought it was ADR, but sure. I understand. Yeah. I mean, I'm shocked. Frankly, I'm just shocked.
Yes. Ooh, how about when Jerry cashed Nana's checks and her account was overdrawn and the guy. The bank called her up and said, you're overdrawn. And she said, I'll be there first thing in the morning.
Mm.
And then she hung up. And then I guess they realized, wait, she can do that over the phone. But if she does, then we don't have a scene. So they have the bank guy very hastily saying as she hangs up, wait, we can do this over the phone.
But
remember that?
It
feels like a detail that they only realize after production. And they're like,
But that's a good save.
It's still good for the comedy. It's a good save, but it's still a little obvious.
It's not just shoved in there.
Not like the other stuff.
No, that's good. That's ADR I can get behind.
I will also never, ever get over how bad the ADR is anytime Larry David is doing Steinbrenner.
Oh, right.
Is it like the first time I saw it
as
a
necessary
kid on
evil because the actor's different.
I know that, but also seeing Seinfeld for the first time on TV when I was younger, there was a weird disconnect when any time Steinbrenner was on screen. It was like, what's happening? Is something wrong? Like, why does he sound wrong? Like, what's happening? I was very confused. I was reminded of it recently because one of my favorite Steinbrenner moments came up, which...
Uh-huh.
When you know George is sleeping under his desk and Steinbrenner's grandkids come in. Does anybody hear that ticking? Shorty, girl?
Yes.
Oh, no, he's trying to sing the song to them to see if they know what song it is. Of course they don't because they're 6 years old. Just referring to your grandchildren as shorty and girl is a real good move.
Yeah. It's like you calling characters girl chan.
Yes, exactly. Yeah,
you probably got it from that. Subconsciously.
I think I did.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because you're a weirdo.
R.L. Steinbrenner.
Okay.
All right, I got nothing.
All right, settle down.
That's all I got. That's all I have for this episode's installment of Seinfeld ADR.
Okie dokie. Well, fantastic.
Yeah.
I look forward to more. Haven't you watched all those episodes yet?
Yes, I'm now looping back around. I'm on season 9 again.
Okay, so you're just basically
it's
you're like
my,
the syndicated airings of Seinfeld, but in your own home.
It's my comfort food at the end of the day.
All right.
There's nothing wrong with that.
There's other shows out there is what I'm saying.
What? Name one.
Pete and Pete.
Lucky guess. Of course, as it's known in Japan, Pete to Pete.
What would it be called?
Pete Otachi. Oretachi Pito.
Yeah, that's good. Yeah, that might be it.
My Buddha's Pito.
Yeah, it'd have to be. It would either be really cute and short or very drawn out.
It would just be Pito and Pito.
Yeah. Sorry, I was lost in thought.
Or Futari no Pito. Futari Kyodai no Pito. Kyodai no Pito.
Well, I don't think we'll ever crack this in time. Let's just move
on. Why? Oh.
Yeah. Let's move on.
The new version of a game called
Like a
Dragon.
Yeah.
Alex, you actually are playing one of these games. The newest one, even.
That's right.
Who could have thought? Who could have seen this coming?
My buddy Brad very generously bought me a copy on Steam, which, boy, I don't know why he can do it for me and I can't do it for him. Because I tried to gift him RE2. I tried to gift him RE2 and Steam said, you can't do that because it's a different region. And then he just gifts me Like a Dragon Ishin, no problem.
Well, publishers handle it differently.
Oh, it's a publisher thing. Okay.
Yeah.
Man, Capcom, get your shit together.
Yeah, that's also weird because doesn't Capcom list that game with both names?
Yeah.
Aren't all their Resident Evil games like also slash Biohazard? Or?
I don't know.
Maybe not anymore. I don't know.
Who knows?
No, yeah, maybe.
But it's good so far. I've only streamed it twice. I think I'm 5 or 6 hours in. I've never really played through a Yakuza game. This is really my first. I played a little bit of Kiwami.
Okay. Yeah.
But yeah, it's pretty good. And this itself is a remake of a PS3 game, or it's a remaster.
Pretty much a remake because they redid the whole thing in Unreal Engine this time.
Oh wow!
Yeah. Rather than their own proprietary stuff, so it's also cool. Sort of a new beginning for the franchise on several levels. But yeah, Ishin was not the first of the feudal spinoffs either.
So it wasn't? Yeah. I thought it was Ishin and then Kenzan. Was there another one before that?
Was it? Am I getting it wrong?
I don't know.
I mix these up so much now.
Because I asked somebody about this at the bar and they said Ishin came first. Hang on.
No. No, Kenzan came first.
Oh, did it?
Yeah.
I knew it. I knew I wasn't crazy.
Because Kenzan came out on PS3 before Yakuza 3 even did.
Ah.
So it was actually the first HD game.
Cool.
Yeah. I think one possible reason they did Ishin instead is because Kenzan deals with some subject matter that might not fly worldwide anymore.
Oh.
Implications of child prostitution from back in the
Ooh.
Day. Yeah.
I'm looking at this
full
now,
story
because yeah.
obviously I haven't played the whole thing, so I don't know Japanese enough. But yeah.
Miyamoto Musashi, 1584 to 1645. Okay, that's a few years ago.
That's a couple.
God, I Googled Yakuza Ishin Kenzan to see the order, but you know how Google, you know, the people also ask section?
Oh, God.
It's like.
Oh, God.
One of the questions is just, who is the strongest in Yakuza? it's like kids Googling Dragon Ball power levels. Who's the strongest one? Who's the best person?
Well, what else are you going to Google?
Who's the strongest fighter? Whoever the writer says is the strong. What? Who fucking cares?
Yes, yes.
Hi, I'm Alex.
I don't even know how that would even come up. Why does that need to be a question?
Yeah, I don't know.
Just play the game.
I think it's just another example of nerds having to quantify everything.
But it's all algorithmically generated.
Hi. What? Those questions?
Essentially.
Huh.
People also ask. Like they're basically aggregating a bunch of different search queries and probably ranking which one comes up. Not that nobody ever wrote the stupid question, but
right.
The fact that they surface it in that way is just like, yeah, I mean, it's probably an amalgam of different kinds of Yakuza questions. And they just came up with, I guess people want to know who's the strongest. I guess there's strong people in this game. Math, AI.
Who's the beefiest lad?
I never wonder that.
No?
No.
Me neither.
No.
I don't know. That seems to just be a part of nerd culture is debates about who is this. Could Superman defeat Goku?
Alex, you know, there's so many different types of nerds now, and mostly the types of nerds you complain about are also the people that show up in your bar and cause problems for you and others. So,
yeah.
I don't think most people interested in the same things we are at our age would really like to do that.
No. Yeah, yeah. I'm not saying our nerd contemporaries. I'm just saying the archetypical person who in all likelihood defines themselves based on the media they consume.
Yes.
I feel like these people are bizarrely obsessed with who is the strongest. Somebody made me put on one of those YouTube videos that's like, could Scorpion kill Ryu from Street Fighter?
There's a whole video about that?
Dude, it's a whole YouTube channel. There's a whole YouTube channel that just pits fictional characters from different franchises against each other based on the logic of their own respective universes. It's the dumbest shit I've ever seen in my goddamn life.
Well, that was a certain television program for many years.
Superman versus Goku is an actual video from that channel.
Right.
And somebody made me watch that video at the bar, and I can't tell you who quote unquote won because I was asleep before it was over.
I don't think you want to know anyway.
No.
Yeah. You know, you remember the show Deadliest Warrior?
Yes. It was like, yeah, who would win, Vikings or samurai? That kind of shit. Jesus fucking Christ. Awesome.
Well, fewer seasons than I thought, but 32 episodes altogether. Yeah.
Wow.
I mean, it's the exact kind of pablum that people eat up, especially on YouTube.
Yeah, so, I know.
Yeah. You know, I was talking about a similar thing on Twitter, just like people who still can't stop comparing like the Super NES and the Genesis.
Oh, man.
And still having like console war type arguments.
Yeah.
It's, like, it's been 30 plus fucking years. Just play the game.
Imagine if like art critics favored, like there was a camp that liked one Renaissance painter over another and they just fought to the bloody death on the internet all the time. Like, how insane would that look?
I think that has happened in a certain form back in the day, just not on the internet. It was just like, you know, you would constantly, I think, have comparisons between like, for example, impressionist painters and stuff, because you knew that those people were like a club, a group of guys, and they were kind of also maybe having their own internal competition. But then you see all their output long after they're dead, and you're like, well, maybe this guy had some advantages over this one. It looks like maybe his breaststrokes are a little bit thicker on this one. His trees look a little bit more defined than so-and-so's.
He did have nice trees.
Yeah. Monet, Manet, I can't tell the difference.
They're two different guys.
Yeah, I know that much, but oh boy. Okay.
One's Claude. The other one is Cloud?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. I don't know. I imagine, yeah, there was at the time there would be a lot of, you know, different artists would have their own supporters and detractors. But after you've been removed by so many decades, everything seems that much sillier.
Right.
It's like we can look back and safely say, oh, they're both fine. They both have, you know, great points and they both had shortcomings and they're both great.
Yeah. And in the games part, it's especially like, hey, you have all the ROMs anyway. Just boot it up. Like,
yeah, it's
you can both play it. Both sides of this argument can play each other's game and also, you know, just experience. In fact, the entire library of the other console, and
that's right.
You know, learn a bit and maybe have some fun with video games, which were supposed to be instruments of fun and enjoyment for children.
Oh, Instruments of Fun is a good name for my YouTube channel.
You can't be 39, wearing your trucker hat, having your retro game argument with the other trucker hat guy over whether or not Sonic had good levels or not.
At the end of the day, and I whine about this on my Twitch streams a lot, all of this shit just comes down to identity. Everybody is starved to have an identity.
Absolutely.
And if you grew up on one side of the console war, guess what? If you haven't learned how to become interesting by the time you're an adult, that's the identity you are going to default to.
Yeah, exactly. I also think that with that particular segment of people, a lot of them are these guys who say things like, you know, video games didn't interest me after high school or whatever. I was more interested in sports and girls and stuff. And now, you know, they're over 40. They got their kids. they're rediscovering that, hey, oh yeah, nostalgia, I like that. I like to be in a kid and playing video games. Hey, video games, hey, that's right. Oh man, remember the Sega Genesis or remember the Super Nintendo? Yeah, I remember that. Oh man, Mario, right? Oh boy. Hey, we used to have fights about which was better, Mario or Sonic, right? And oh boy, hey, it turns out we can still have those fights with other people.
Serious question though, how many drugs do you think they did when they made Mario? Was it a lot?
Please, we're recording this before the movie's out. I'll have a stronger answer for you afterward.
I think I may need to see that movie twice. I do want to see the Japanese dub as well as the English dub. I'm very curious.
We are probably recording this a bit early. So the movie will have already happened. And
what?
Everything.
It's not going to be out in Japan until like, I think 420 Blaze It is when it comes out in Japan.
Oh, that's right. It's late in Japan, of course. I forgot. But it's next week here. As much as I would have enjoyed being a 39-year-old man going on, the premiere date or whatever, probably not a smart thing to do. So I think I can just encourage me and the wife to go on Friday or Saturday or something.
There you go.
Otherwise, yes, in an ideal world where I was still a single, very happy Mario fan, probably a couple decades younger as well, sure, I would have walked into a theater alone to watch that as soon as I could. But it doesn't work that way anymore.
I used to see movies alone all the time when I was in college.
And my baby's too young to even care. Ugh. I gotta wait years for him to like have interests in things besides jangly toys. Oh, boy.
You've been jangling the keys in front of him for weeks, but he still doesn't know how to drive.
Right. I do want to reassure you and the audience, I'm not going to be one of those people forcing my childhood video games on my child.
Yeah.
It's not going to be a thing. Let's let it happen naturally, okay?
Yes. I do see some of that. I also do know a lot of people who have kids who have naturally gravitated towards games.
Of course. Yes.
Who have like, you know, the dad had a Super Nintendo classic or whatever, and the kid's like, oh, the kid really likes Super Mario World.
He's going to be around it. He's going to get introduced to it one way or another. Right. Just not like, all right, son, here's your education. You're going to sit down and play Duck Hunt the same way I did when I was 5 on Christmas 1988.
Can you imagine that? Can you imagine Christmas 1988? No, but I mean, can you imagine like our fathers sitting us down in the 80s and being like, you're going to play Duck Hunt because it's a classic. Like, Dad, you're fucking scaring me, dude. I just this attitude of like
this thing, I might not make it.
I hate this attitude of like, it's my responsibility to teach my children about classic video games.
To be fair, I think that sort of stuff, you know, at least has not been surfaced on any of my internet feeds. So I don't see it that often anymore. That you made fun of maybe 15 years ago.
I'm basing it mostly on people that I've met in real life. And I've met examples of both. I've met people who don't do that. And I've met people who do do that.
Let's go back to bar talk for a second.
Bar talk.
I mean, Mario is timeless anyway. Nintendo has made sure of that. So,
yeah,
it's going to happen one way or another.
Nintendo, huh?
Now, am I right?
What else can I complain about?
I can go back to Resident Evil. You know, the reason I wasn't playing the remake of 4 was A, I was trying to finish the original, but also B, I wanted to play the other remakes all the way through as well, because I haven't done that yet.
The other remakes are good. People don't like the Resident Evil 3 remake, but I enjoyed it.
It had a budget feel to it, because it was a different company making it, and so they just kind of... I mean, it also came out less than a year after 2 did, so it was just which I think is also reflective of history, if I remember right.
Yeah,
the PS1 version. So
I found that the reason I enjoyed 3 is because it addressed my only complaint in about 2, the remake of 2, which is I understand that ammo has to be scarce to maintain that sort of horror atmosphere. It's a little too scarce in the RE2 remake, and it kind of made me...
Oh, yeah.
Like, I play games to relax. I like a little bit of horror tension and anxiety, but, like, the ammo is a little too scary. RE3, you're just swimming in ammo the whole game. I understand that from a game design perspective, it makes the game less scary. But from the perspective of just an adult in my 30s, who I don't have that much time to play games, like, I prefer this. I like just being able to play the game.
Yeah. Also, they made Resident Evil 6, so that argument's out the window anyway. Who cares if it's scary or not at this point? Oh, okay. You know what I mean?
I didn't play 6.
Well, I mean, it's basically a third-person shooter.
Oh, fun. I did enjoy 3, despite the fact... People also complain that the clock, they cut the clock tower out of it. I think people are misremembering how fun the clock tower was. People have weird... cozy recollections of this clock tower area, which was just kind of a big nothing. But people like to get angry about cut content in any form and insist they were shortchanged. Now, I do have a weird complaint. I think I mentioned this on the show before, but real quick.
Do you have any weird complaints? I don't think so.
I never do.
So go ahead.
All of my grievances are bizarre.
Mm-hmm.
There is a pamphlet on a park bench in the Resident Evil 3 remake. I think what they did is they just copied over all the assets, all the lore assets wholesale without stopping to consider that they fit. There's a pamphlet on a park bench you can interact with. And when you read it, it's just visit the historic Raccoon City clock tower. Boy, I sure wish I could, but you forgot to put it in the game. It's gone. Why is this pamphlet here?
You know, there's a chance that was tongue in cheek.
Really?
Could be. I mean, you know, games are getting so cheeky these days, right?
Yeah, I don't know.
that's my argument.
All right.
And good night.
Bye. I don't know that I don't need cheek from my games.
Well, you're getting it. Right in your face.
Ow. Stop that. Jesus.
No.
Where's my punch sound effect? That would have been perfect.
Optimus!
That's good enough.
That's good enough. Right, yes.
I think that's what I'm going to do this weekend is just start playing through RE4 on baby mode for babies.
Yeah.
And try to enjoy it.
Who needs to be an adult? Except I was just complaining about people who act like children.
Games shouldn't feel like work.
No.
Know what I mean?
We're beyond it.
We are.
There's also the people, the retro game fans, who think games need to be as hard as they were in 1986.
No, it really
doesn't have to be that way. There's really no status or pride attached to it. You don't really need to play it any certain way. You can have the fun any way you want. Anyway, I'm not saying anything new to you, Alex, but there you go.
If I haven't seen it, it's new to me.
Uh-huh.
Wait, do you have new episodes of Mad About You?
Yeah, I do. Make a new Mad About You, yeah.
Yeah, they did.
Yeah.
Mad About You, the continuation?
I think it was, I don't know what it's called.
To me, all of Mad About You is new to me because I've never seen any of it.
Right.
Yeah.
Seen a couple episodes, but.
Yeah.
Certainly not by like eager choice because I was a kid. It wasn't really a kid's friendly kind of show.
What about Will Toe Grace?
No. I was pretty much out of the game at that point. I pretty much stopped caring.
What about Caroline in the City?
Now that I loved.
Okay. Really?
Yeah. No cap.
What?
Nah, sorry. I was being a cool kid. That's a cool thing kids say.
No cap?
Yeah.
What does that mean?
I'm not lying.
No cap.
Yeah.
All right.
You know, Zoomers, those people you hate.
I want a hot dog.
Yeah.
Those people breaking your Super Famicom?
It's also Boomers doing that. Don't forget.
Yeah, but you said Zoomers as well. So, you know.
It's both.
We just got to be sure. What's going on?
It's, you're either too young or you're too old.
Anyway, Caroline in the City. Let's watch some episodes of that on YouTube.
Okay. You want to do a whole show where we just talk about Caroline in the City?
I could, yeah.
Okay.
I think we're running low on sitcoms to do podcasts about in the world. So I think Carolina City's free. Yeah, we could do a whole series retrospective podcast on that. Yeah.
Okay. It's gotta have a clever name.
Right.
Caroline. What rhymes with Caroline and means conversation?
Strychnine.
No. Or wait, Caroline in the witty, because we're being witty about.
Yeah.
No, I don't know.
Okay.
Caroline in the shitty.
Okay. Yeah. Well,
Caroline in the silly.
I don't think it aged well. Yeah, maybe.
Caroline in the public discourse.
Okay. Yeah. Right.
Okay.
Talking Carol.
Whose Caroline is it anyway?
Oh, there we go. Yeah, we're doing pretty good. I think we're really nailing it.
All right, what's our podcast for Murphy Brown?
I don't. Murphy Brown Nosen.
Okay.
See, I'm not as good as you.
Murphy Brown Table.
Okay.
All right.
That's good.
What about our show? What's our podcast where we discuss Dr. Quinn Medicine Woman?
I just don't want to watch that.
Yeah, I don't think I do. Was that, who was in that?
Jane
Mary
Seymour.
Steenburgen. Oh, Jane Seymour.
Yeah.
Why do I confuse Jane Seymour with Mary Steenburgen?
I don't know.
All right.
I do not know. That's a weird thing.
All right.
Was Mary Steenburgen ever on a series?
I think the only context I've seen her on TV is in like Hallmark movies.
Oh, right. Yes.
But I don't think she was in any series. I've definitely seen her in like made for TV Hallmark movies.
Oh no. She was on the sitcom Inc. on
what?
CBS.
The hell is Inc?
That is Inc as in the black ink pen ink.
Okay.
Oh my God. Yeah. I think I remember this.
Not to be confused with Inked.
No. 96 okay. to 97.
All right.
Real life husband and wife, Ted Danson and Mary Steenburgen, as divorced newspaper journalists.
Whoa.
Allegedly inspired. Why allegedly inspired by the film His Girl Friday?
Allegedly inspired.
What the hell, Wikipedia? What does that mean?
What does that mean?
Maybe this next sentence says something about that. The show's pilot was drastically changed and reshot from the original version. Nah, I guess maybe that was it.
Oh, wow. So it only lasted 96, 97, I assume, because we all got so engrossed with our new N64s, we stopped watching television.
Yeah, it aired after the launch of the N64. So October 21, 96 to May 19th, 97. Yes.
Bad time for TV. And then FF7 came out later in the year.
Yeah. Crazy. Oh my goodness.
What's your best memory of Final Fantasy VII?
That's a good question. I don't really know.
I would say, I mean, for me, it's probably the pod race.
Oh, of course, right.
Yeah. Which is really cool.
Sebulba.
Yes.
Watto.
Yeah.
What a couple of cut-ups.
Who else was in that? There's a robot. The Sklar brothers voiced a two-headed alien that I quoted earlier in this episode. What a coincidence. We have fun.
Such a great coincidence. Sounds like maybe we should end the show on that.
I think that's a good... Wait, we're still in segment two.
Oh, no. Okay. Let's quickly move to segment three.
Wait, do we need to take a break?
Yeah, let's take a break.
All right.
We talked enough.
We did.
Let's exhale.
I've been waiting to exhale.
Very good.
Put another the trailer for that right here. Hi.
Savannah.
Another great 90s movie.
Bernadine.
Pretty good.
We'll be back.
Robin. Gloria. Four friends. Determined to face reality.
The one man I love is married and got a kid.
Will you tell my baby girl that her daddy loves her?
To find the perfect love.
Michael is not pretty, but he's available.
You get the best loving in the world when a man is begging.
To take control of their lives.
I'm leaving you for her.
You wait a minute. I give you 11 years of my life and you're telling me you're leaving me for another woman? and to make dreams come true.
Would you like to have dinner with us tonight? There's just leftovers. Collard greens, some cornbread, some candied yams, a little potato salad, fried chicken, peach cobbler, few slices of ham. I have no business eating it myself, big as I am.
I like that. I like a woman with a little meat on her bones, you know?
Ooh, give me some!
20th Century Fox proudly presents...
But I have to admit, I haven't seen anything as splendid as you since I've been here. Okay, hold on now. Hold on. You don't have to give me that look.
Whitney Houston.
I know if I left right now, it would be the wrong time. So we're going to have to wait a little bit longer than I expected.
You see, the more I think about it, the more I look at you, you look like the scum of the earth.
Angela Bassett.
I need somebody to hold me, even if it is a damn lie.
Lila Rashan.
Does he think he just did something here?
I could have had a V8.
And Loretta Devine.
Oh, God, I hope he's not watching me walk away.
All right.
He's watching.
In a story of the challenges that make us stronger.
I always thought if I gave him what he needed, he'd give me what I needed.
You know, some of us are still in that dream trip, girl.
And the friends that get us through it all. Waiting to Exhale, directed by Forrest Whitaker.
Oh, you ready? I was about to watch Caroline the City.
No, I don't have time. It's
You're
a
not
series.
Ready, so I can watch Caroline the City. Okay, here we go.
All right, fine.
Mary, wow. I do not want to be around when you break the news to Caroline.
Okay.
Is that it?
Yeah, it was a whole episode. Must see TV.
What? Oh, micro TV. Okay.
Folks, we're back. It's No More Whoppers. I am Ray. I believe still at this moment that is Alex.
Webisodes.
Oh boy. Quibi.
Webinars?
Yeah.
All right.
Quibi was in the news this week.
Who was?
Quibi.
Oh, why? I thought Quibi was dead.
Well, reports suggest Quibi's failure led to Reese Witherspoon's divorce.
What?
I don't think we should get into it, but we
no.
Her husband was responsible for a lot of Quibi, and then, I don't know, maybe they fought a lot about how you pronounce Quibi.
Well,
like
I hope they patch it up. Moving on.
Yep.
Here's, guess what? Are you done? Do we have to talk about this?
No.
Okay. Thank you. So, our next segment, let's start from the beginning. Alexander Graham Bell invented a thing called the telephone. Raymond, are you familiar with this?
Yeah, didn't that get disputed?
Oh, was it?
No, or was that the light bulb?
I don't know. Well, light bulb was Thomas Edison.
Yeah, right. But was that also disputed? I don't know.
I think they both killed elephants.
All I know is that Steve Jobs invented the iPhone.
That's yes. Was it Edison who killed the elephant by demonstrating his alternating current or direct current?
No, that was Ryden.
Okay.
Yeah.
And then Alexander Graham Bell killed an elephant, I want to say in a fist fight. Or no. He invented the telephone, and then he had the phone ring and the elephant picked it up, and then he yelled into the phone and he frightened the elephant to death.
Oh, yeah. I think that was Black Bolt.
It's a classic. What? What is that?
Black Bolt, a superhero in the Marvel Universe. Did you watch Doctor Strange?
No.
In the Multiverse of Madness?
I'm out. I'm done.
Check it out.
I'm good. I'm fine. I'm all marveled out.
We'll see about that.
I will go back to the MCU when I am eventually bedridden and have nothing to do. But until then, like, I'm good.
Now that's not going to happen. You're going to have so many JRPGs to play.
That's right. And I'm still just going to play through FF6 a million times.
Of course.
Yeah.
God damn it.
All right. So the telephone, fast forward to the internet, where we, thanks to some help from Google, we have approximated a telephone line using computers. Yeah. Now, you can call this number at 805-NMW-TALK AKA 805-669-8255. Give us a call. We'll play you on the show like I'm about to do right now. Ray, are you ready?
Yeah, I just want to let you know that NMW stands for No Man's Wand.
That's true. It's good now, people. Why don't you give it a chance?
What?
No Man's Wand.
Oh.
Sorry, I thought that was supposed to be a No Man's Sky.
No.
Reference,
just but me I guess being that silly.
That would have been No Man's Why.
Yeah, right.
All right. No Man's Land, of course, I believe was a term used during the First World War to refer to, I don't know, dangerous areas?
You can play the voice
on the battlefield. All right, here we go.
Hey, right now, it's Questmoreland here with the Dream Corner for you. I dreamt that I was walking up to Critical Hit, and Alex and five other people were having a Mortal Kombat tournament outside with one of those media carts set up in the snow for some reason. Inside the bar was as you'd expect, except that the back wall opened up into a store like a Tuesday morning, like just a big warehouse. I told Alex that I realized I was lucid dreaming. He said, oh, make sure to tell me tomorrow to see if I remember. Anyway, checking to see if you remember my dream, Alex. And hopefully I'm not too late with this, but congratulations on 10 years.
Thank you, Questmoreland. I do remember that. It was very fun. It was good to see you. Questmoreland, obviously, calling in. He's on some sort of pay-by-the-second phone plan where he's got to get it out in under 30 seconds.
We had a baby. It's a boy.
Bob had a baby. It's a boy. Thank you for the call. Does this transcript contain any gold? Hey, right now, exclamation mark for you. That's a pretty good opening.
Uh-huh.
All right. Yeah, it's not too bad.
Hey, right now, exclamation mark for you.
I did have a dream. I did have something similar happen where I was wondering, this took place in the real world, but I was I couldn't get FF14 to run at 120 FPS on one of my monitors, my primary monitor.
Yeah.
And I Googled it, and I guess it matters which monitor is connected to which port in your graphics card.
Oh, yeah.
And I didn't have the time to confirm it, and I forgot about it. And then I went to bed and I had a dream that I asked my friend Paul, who is a computer guy, hey, is it true that it depends on which port it's plugged into in your graphics card? And I did. He gave me an answer that I didn't understand at all. And I've been meaning to ask him for real the next time I see him. And specifically, Ed, I asked you this in a dream, but I didn't understand your answer. Can you please be more clear this time?
Yeah.
And we'll see. Wow. Yeah, lucid dreams are great. You could play any game you want.
Yeah.
Even Gex Jr. What was that?
Right.
Yeah.
Did you finish reading the transcript?
No. I think it turned into an... I don't know. Let's give it a go. Hey, right now, exclamation mark for you. I dreamed that I was walking up to Critical Hit and Alex and find other people are having a Mortal Kombat tournament outside with one of those media cards and set up in the snow. For some reason, inside the bar was, as you'd expect, except that the back wall opened up into a store like a Tuesday morning, like just a big warehouse. I told Alex that I realized I was lucid dreaming, and he said, oh, make sure to tell me tomorrow to see if I remember anyway. Checking to see if you remember my dream, Alex, and hopefully I'm not too late with this, but congratulations on 10 years.
All right.
All right, it's pretty normal, but not bad. Thank you very much. It's been 11 years, right?
Yeah, of what? The show?
Of NoMoWo, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, it's very possible that he recorded this a year ago and then only sent it in now.
Yeah, that can happen.
I will assume that that's what it is.
You know, when you record a sound file on your phone,
yeah,
and then you just hold it up to another phone that's called your voicemail line. Yeah.
Speaking of sound files on your phone, why don't we play a little game called What's in My Voice Memos?
Okay. Alex's voice memo corner? Are you showering?
Oh, no, it's me whistling. I think I was trying to come up with a song.
Hey, right. Tom, it's Alex.
Nope.
It sounded like you were whistling in the shower.
There you go.
Hey, Tom, it's Alex. Fraley. Look, I just wanted to check in. And...
Okay. That was a gag I was sending to my friend Tom.
All right.
This one's just called Alex Uximo.
Uximo. Uximo. Uximo. Uximo.
What the fuck?
Uximo.
Okay. I think one of the talent agencies wanted me to record myself saying Uximo a bunch.
Okay. Okay. Yeah.
I did not get any job for anything called Uximo.
All right. Just wanted to laugh over at the office.
I've been saying D'Souza.
What? Wait, what is this?
Wait, is it D'Souza? I've been saying D'Souza.
I don't know what that is.
Wait, is it John Philip Sousa or John Philip Sosa?
Is it from this show?
All right, okay. All right, I agree.
I don't remember.
I think it's a show.
It's from September 23rd, 2021.
All right.
Oh, yeah, I think that is from this show, actually. All right.
It sounds very No More Whoppers-y.
Yes. All right, let's move on to our next phone call. Here it is. Here we go.
Hi, this is Alex from Nagoya.
That's true. That's true. Thank you, Laz and Arcade Bear. Meanwhile,
it's just a recording from my own stream of Ishin. Thank you, Smoo. Thank you for recording me streaming and sending it in.
No, that was you. You said it was Alex from Nagoya.
What? Hang on.
Yeah. Hi, this is Alex from Nagoya.
Oh, yeah, you're right. Okay. Yep. I guess I forgot doing that. All right.
You can recognize yourself, can't you?
I can. Here's one that really stretches the upper limits of our time limit. I'm going to play this now.
Oh, yes.
ChatGPT, write a scene where Ray Barnholt and Alex Fraioli from the podcast No More Poppers argue. Ray Barnholt and Alex Fraioli had been working together on their video game podcast, No More Whoppers, for years. They had built a loyal fan base and were respected voices in the gaming community. However, they were known to disagree from time to time. One day, while recording an episode of their podcast, they got into a heated argument about a particular game. Ray felt the game was poorly designed and not worth playing, while Alex argued that it was a classic and it deserved more respect. Their voices grew louder and more tense as they went back and forth, each trying to convince the other of their viewpoint. Finally, Ray slammed his fist down on the table and said, "I can't believe you're defending this garbage. It's a waste of time and not worth anyone's money." Alex's face grew red as he responded, "You're just being stubborn. You can't see the value in this game because you're too busy being negative all the time. You're the one who's a waste of time." The two sat in silence for a few moments, each breathing heavily and staring daggers at each other. Finally, Ray spoke up in a calmer tone. "Look, we're not going to agree on everything, but let's move on from this and focus on the next topic." Alex grunted in agreement and continued with their podcast. Despite their argument, they both knew that they respected each other's opinions and that they would continue to work together on the show. They had learned that it was okay to disagree and that it was a natural part of any healthy friendship or working relationship.
Wow. That's ChatGPT?
I guess so. I got to say, wow. The characterization was way off. It got us completely wrong. You're more of the fist pounding type.
I am, definitely. I mean, this is a new desk. I'm probably not going to pound it for another few years.
Philosophically, you pound the desk.
Yes.
Because you're so hopped up on coffee all the time.
Yeah, I'm hopped up on calf balls.
There's a part of this transcript that interprets my name in a way that is slightly offensive.
Yeah, we're not going to read the transcript. It's also very long. All right. Thank you, ChatGPT. working through Smoo. All right. We have one
Can't
more.
Wait for more.
Look, I'm pretty sure this is also Smoo. Here we go.
Really?
Hi, guys. My name is also Alex Adewim from Discord.
No.
I wanted to write Earth Call with a No Mo Wo dream I had a little while ago. I was listening to the podcast, and you were talking about when you were writing for games, game sites. One of Alex's guides was a modern style, SEO'd single question article. The title of the article was Final Fantasy 1 Pantsless. Should you wear pants in Final Fantasy? My brain was in American mode at the moment, by the way, so I am talking about trousers. Anyway, I don't think you could take the trousers off in Final Fantasy. Anyway, looking forward to the new Patreon bonus show. Have a nice podcast recording. Bye.
Thank you. Yes, guess what? Final Fantasy 14, you can go trouserless. Don't worry about it.
Oh, was it 14? For some reason, I heard Final Fantasy 1. But no,
Is this only talking about Final Fantasy 1? Then, I guess you can't. Well, hang on. Wait a minute. Hang on.
You can boost the...
Can I?
No, I mean later.
Oh, in post. Okay, hang on.
The title of the article was Final Fantasy 1 pantsless.
Yeah. Pants. Okay. Thank you, AGOM. Another Alex. Always a pleasure.
Final Fantasy 1 pantsless run.
I mean, certainly the player can do it pantsless.
Oh, yeah, right.
I think, I mean, if we need to run some more tests on this, I'm perfectly willing to take an afternoon.
You can also hack the ROM, the graphics in the ROM.
I don't really consider ROM hacks to be any sort of official.
No, it's really just the graphics. I mean, you wouldn't really be touching anything else. You'd still play the game normally, just that nobody would have pants.
Even right. Garland.
Oh, yeah, if you could manage it.
And I could.
Yeah.
Okay. All right.
I like how you thought that was smooth at first, even though the number clearly said plus 4-4. Completely different country code.
Here's why I thought it was smooth, is because the transcript thinks that the first line is, like I said, my name is also Alexander, which is a very smooth way to open a phone call.
Right. Yeah, it is. I get you. Yeah. It was just...
Yeah. Hence my erroneous assumption.
Just a number from a different country.
That's fun. Number from another mother, we say.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Well, those are some good voicemails, I'd say.
Those are some great voicemails. Yes. If you guys want to call us, you can do so at 805 No Man's Y 8255.
Right.
That's 805-669-8255. Call today and secure your spot on the wall of fame. Call today to register. We're selling blades of grass.
Oh, okay.
Call today. Register a cloud. That's a super ego skit. Or just call to talk about, a dream you had, an experience you had, a weirdo that you saw, an over nerd, perhaps.
Yeah.
There's no shortage of them. They're out there.
Of course. Absolutely. Well, thank you, everybody.
Maybe you were taking out the garbage and you saw somebody cosplaying a Suikoden 3 character?
Yeah. Actually, yeah.
Giant duck?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Remember that guy on the forum who was obsessed with Suikoden 3?
The forum?
The old gaff.
Oh, no.
Okay.
No, I don't.
The guy who claimed he was from Japan.
Uh-oh.
Discovered he was
not. I do remember one guy who claimed he was from Japan.
Mm-hmm.
I also remembered another guy who was like vociferously arguing in favor of like keeping women down in Japan because that's their culture.
Okay.
It was one of those, and this is pre like MRA movement, but it was very much like, you look, it's wrong to judge another culture. So like, when Japan keeps women down, you just, when in Rome, that's what you're supposed to do. And it was like defending it in the most bizarre way that I'd ever seen.
Just what you're supposed to. Yeah, right. I don't remember that. A lot of creeps and idiots passed through there for sure. But I don't remember anything like that. I was just talking about Suikoden 3.
Oh, we cannot judge Suikoden 3 as it is a product of Japan.
Well, you got me there. gosh darn it. Okay.
All right. I would like to play that game someday. Well, I've played it before, but I would like to give it another...
A fair shake?
A fair shake, yes.
All right, good luck. How about 4 and 5?
5 I like, 4 I've never played.
Oh.
5's great.
All right.
That's why it was disappointing that the series kind of finally returned to form with 5. And then they just abandoned it.
Yeah.
I mean, there was tactics, there was tier crease, but there's not like a Suikoden 6, and there's probably not going to be.
Don't forget, never mind. That probably was not a real game.
What?
I wanted to say Suikoden Card Stories. Was that anything?
Card Stories?
I think it was, yeah.
There was a Suiko Gaiden.
yes. Yeah, Card Stories was a GBA game. It was throwaway stuff. It was just It was just a CCG game.
Gross. That's not my kind of thing.
I know. That's why I brought it up. For humor.
Oh.
Hey.
What if we were to make a No More Whoppers CCG?
All right. Sounds like a nightmare for you personally.
Yeah. But I would play it if somebody made it.
I don't know how to design games that use paper though. So.
Oh.
It's not my bag.
Baby.
I need to put numbers into a computer to make a game.
Okay.
You get me?
Yeah, I think I do.
You catch my shit?
Yeah, I do.
I don't know what that means. But okay, good.
All right.
Why can't you do something for us, Mr. Yamato Takeru no Mikoto?
That's Japan. That's where I am.
That's Suikoden 4.
All right, are we good to wrap it up?
Are we? I think so.
I think we are. We had a great time. I had a great time.
It's No More Whoppers. Yeah. NoMoreWhoppers.com is our website. You can find everything you need to there. Yes, that's right. Even your news and weather.
Wait, what?
We have a Patreon, patreon.com/NoMoreWhoppers. You can give us $1 a month just to be cool, or give us $5 a month, and we be cool to you by giving you a show a week early without ads, and also a bonus show, which is currently called Gold in 16 Seconds.
Yes, which, by the way,
it's a milestone episode.
What?
This next episode is a milestone.
It is.
Yeah.
It's very important for purposes of that show. And that show only has 4 episodes left, including this next one.
Yeah. So who knows what we'll do in the final 4 episodes? It's kind of like the end of Breaking Bad. It's like there was this huge swell at the near the very end. And you're like, wow, there's like 2 more episodes left. What the fuck? How are they going to what? And then.
Yes. How are they going to get out of this one?
Yeah, exactly. How's Willie White getting out of this one?
Willie White, isn't it wanky?
No, that's offensive.
Oh, Tim British. Watley, sorry,
Tim Watley. Yeah,
there we go. How's Tim Watley gonna get out of this one?
Okay.
I have a suspicion Tim Watley is cooking meth purely for the jokes. This offends you as a meth user? No, it offends me as a comedian.
Right. Yeah, that's... they should film that. Anyway, cool. Yes, milestone episode of Golden 16 Seconds. So get on the train now. $5 a month. Don't miss it.
Choo-choo.
It's part of all that fancy stuff. We have a Discord, which you can find linked on nomorewhoppers.com. It's open for everybody. You don't need to be on Patreon. Just come on in. Say hi. That's all you need to say, really. And, of course, our phone number for voicemail, 805-NMW-TALK. You can... well, you know what? The ChatGPT thing was pretty good. I would say don't overdo it.
I think
voicemail line with those, but it was
there's
good.
Also, yeah, there's a risk of overdoing ChatGPT stuff because I was watching Infinite Hams, Infinite Steams, the Steamed Hams ChatGPT Twitch channel.
Steamed Hams one. I haven't heard about this. I just know Seinfeld one.
I missed the Seinfeld one. I think it got taken down as soon as it got racist.
Well, no, it got put back up.
Oh, okay. But somebody did a Steamed Hams one, and it is
okay.
Funny for the first couple of minutes.
Funny.
Yes. But then after a while, like, even though it'll still keep saying silly things, it's still silly in a predictable way.
Yeah. Well, that's the whole thing with trying to make funny stuff out of the AI things, because everything just sounds like a bad essay, and it's only funny like once or twice, and that's like, okay,
yeah, it's,
that's cute. I guess we could do a lot of fun with that. Oh, well.
Anyway, robots are going to take our jobs. Voicemail, call in, 805-NMW-TALK.
Well, robots can also mimic our voices, and we've recorded a lot of podcasts, so I think...
That's true.
Yeah. I think we're screwed.
Probably.
I'd also like to mention our merchandise, shop.spreadshirt.com/NoMoreWhoppers. We have shirts and stickers and buttons for your perusal. Thank you very much. Gives us a little bit of money, and who knows, someone might still like us and want to buy a shirt.
Oh yeah, the shirt. Get a shirt, put it on your bod.
We're on Twitter as No More Whoppers. I'm going first.
Oh,
that's right, it's a new sheriff in town, bitch.
What?
You can find everything about me on rdbaaa. Dot space. That's three A's.
Wow. Alex, wait, so wait, rdbaaa. Dot space.
No, no, no. rdbaaa.
Okay.
You should know this.
So wait, when you say three A's, you mean there's two in your name and then one in the space?
Right, so four total.
Okay. Oh, okay, so two and two.
Well, no, not equal. Not spread equally. There's three in the back and then one in the front.
So it's RDB and then space with four A's.
No. I just said RDBAAA.
AAA. Dot com.
Do you... Are you my mom?
/org.
This is like having a conversation with my mom.
Dot PHP. /? Dogs.
You can just tell me when the bit's over.
It's done.
Okay.
They died on the vine.
Alex on the internet. Who is he? Where is he?
Hi. You can just go to patui.org. That's PITOHUI.org to find all my stuff. Like my Twitch, which is Hooded Patui, and my Twitter, which is Patui. Or the bar's Twitter, which is Critical Hit Nag. I will be doing YouTube stuff sooner or later. I think that's going to be a new channel, but you can find my original channel at Hooded Patui. That's the username. I don't know how you search YouTube. I'm probably going to start a brand new channel, start from zero. I feel like it's the right thing to do. I met with a moralist, a professional moralist, before I started this endeavor, and he said it's the right thing to do.
Oh.
Yeah.
Hope it wasn't Jordan Peterson.
No.
Okay.
Jesus Christ.
That's all I thought of when you said moralist.
No, I thought I was making up a profession.
Well, for some reason, that's what I connected in my head.
Ew, gross.
Sorry.
Okay.
I'm sorry. Will you forgive me, please?
You have to say forgiven us, please.
No, that's racist.
Not if you... Yeah, I guess it is.
Yeah.
All right.
Racist now. Sorry.
I will forgive you.
Oh, no, not for... okay, well, fine.
Oh.
Fair enough. Okay.
Hey, also, don't forget to come to the bar.
Oh, yeah. Okay, yes.
It's called Critical Hit. It's in Nagoya, Japan. It's right off the Beltline. It's next to the Hilton Hotel in Fushimi. Come on down. Play Low G Man. Have a beer.
All right.
Yeah.
Okay.
And for the love of God, call ahead if you're bringing a small army with you.
Yeah, you ever think about trying to make that somehow more prominent on like a on the Yelp page or something or other? Because it feels like there needs to be a better way to get that message across. I don't know. I'm not criticizing you. I'm honestly asking.
I have. Oh yeah, the only places I have it written down are at the bar, which I guess kind of make them pointless. Yeah, I should probably add it
inside the bar behind you.
I mean, I've mentioned it on social media before, but I don't have like a dedicated, I guess there's a portion of my website that's devoted to the bar where I could mention it, but I don't know. It's, you know, I don't have a website for the bar anymore because I'm trying to minimize the web presence. So I've just got the social medias.
Right. Cause you're going to close at an indeterminate date.
Well, no, it's because I want to keep Nintendo off my ass.
Oh, right. That part. The original thing. Yeah. Okay. I thought you meant the new reason.
I want people to know I exist, but not the government. Which is a little tricky. Honestly.
All right.
But yeah,
thank
I would...
Thank you, John McAfee.
I would like to... I got to make it a rule now that reservations require a 10,000 yen deposit. That's going forward. At least that one I can enforce by like telling people when they try to make a reservation. Like, okay, cool, that's 10,000. That's a cool 10 G's, Bill. Like, why was that the name I spat out?
I don't know. Mr. Gates?
All right. That's it. That's all I got.
Fine. Okay. I also make some video games. Whatever. You can go to rdbaa.space. Alex, thank you so much for being a good sport this time on the show.
Anytime.
Anytime on the show. Okay. Everybody else, keep your nose clean. We'll see you next time here on No More Whoppers. Gold subscribers, stick around till after the show. You know what? We have a confession to make. This show has been pre-recorded this entire time.
Someone on my Twitch chat reminded me that Monk Season 1 had a different opening theme song. And I pulled it up on stream and listened to it. And it's I remembered it's a genre of music I call Pixar core.
Okay, yeah.
Hang on, let me play it for you.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Hang on a sec. You see what I mean?
A little bit, yeah.
It sounds like the music you hear in the background of every Pixar short.
Okay, right. Yeah, the shorts for sure. Yeah, I get it.
You know what I mean?
Jerry's Game.
What?
Jerry's Game was one of the shorts.
Oh, okay. What was that about?
Old man playing chess.
All right. You want to play chess with me?
Not particularly.
Why?
I don't really know how to play.
I'll teach you.
No, it's okay. I'll just stick with the what's the game called? Clubhouse Games.
I was about to say, yeah, you have Clubhouse Games. Let's play Clubhouse Games together.
Yeah, but not chess.
All right, fine. Shogi.
I'm not that big a Japanophile.
Oh, could have fooled me.
Des.